Tonight on Ship Chasing, another FFPC main event draft, $2,000 buy-in, chasing $1 million. We got Gretch, we got Pat Corain, and of course, our guest of honor, RotoViz's Sean Siegel. It's tonight on Ship Chasing. Let's roll. Do you guys know ball?
Pat Fryer Helmo.
This is why I'm hot.
Anita Hanjob.
Fix your sight.
Jamar. Alpha play chase.
Are you kidding me? Kadarius Toney?
You can't handle the heat.
It looks like we're finally at this point. You're right.
Sean, are we still piss boys? Are we robust RB boys now? Because I've been drafting with you, and I don't think you're a piss boy anymore.
How many running backs did we take in the first seven rounds yesterday?
It was a lot. Someone asked me in my Discord, Sean. There was, and I haven't even gotten around to responding. They go, he said, Pete, I want you to know, what did you honestly think about the team you drafted with Sean yesterday?
Wait, how many running backs did you draft?
We drafted four through, was it seven or eight? And then we did add Kenny Gainwell as well. So it ended up being five total. It happens. It happens.
I've done stuff like that occasionally.
Yeah, you know, you got to live a little. Of course, Corain, Gretch, Sean Siegel joining us. Of course, you know, it's fun because, Sean, I remember, you know, a few years ago, we would have you on for a couple shows, like one early in the summer or early in August, and then we would maybe draft a team. And it was so rare to get you on stream or to even do like podcast stuff because you were mainly exclusively writing. And now I feel like we're blessed with you doing all kinds of podcasts with Colm, with Gretch. You've been doing the show with me. How does it feel to now be just part of the content churn here in the fantasy football space?
Well, I love it. The podcasting has been an absolute blast. And yeah, I mean, the only question is whether it makes this like just not so special. I did appreciate it last year when you made that same basic point and people chimed in and said, we can never get enough. So, you know, just somebody throw that in there for me.
It's still special, Sean. When you do a draft for $1 million, and I do think this year is particularly unique because we joked about the piss boy stuff, but we have a very unique landscape in drafts right now, and I think we're going to get to put some of those ideas to the test here.
I never thought someone asking for validation could be so endearing, but pulled it off.
And 2 minutes into the show, chat, come on, help him out, man. There it is. Historical anomalies just got you. They could never do it.
There you go. Come on. There's no such thing as enough. That's right. But just don't call him your zero RB king, or he might disappoint you on that front. all right. So we're off to the races here. We're drafting from the 1-6 tonight. I think a spot we're all excited about. You know, especially in this kind of landscape that's still settling ADP wise, you know, there's lots of fun stuff you can do from the middle part of the board. We see Jefferson, Chase, Kelce, Hill come off the board. We're about to be on deck from 1-6 here. McCaffrey still on the board. Cooper Kupp still on the board. Austin Eckler on the board here. Any initial thoughts from you guys?
Well, Chase went 2 again, which I guess is I don't know. I thought Kelce was going to be locked in at 2. I mean, I obviously get taking Chase there, though.
I had another 3 where I got, yeah. I mean, I've got, because we had one together as well, and I've had a couple 3s and gotten Kelce in both. It's like I haven't seen Chase go 3. I've seen, but like the ADP says that Kelce's going
to. The ADP says Kelce's 2. Yeah.
No one actually wants to click Kelce at 2 anymore.
Yeah.
Does that happen in our draft with the stat chasing guys, right? So Cooper Kupp does go, guys. We had looked at him initially. Is this a CMC pick for you guys or anything else you want to float?
Well, this does throw a wrench into the pre-draft plan that we had put together. I was actually going to pitch a more aggressive pre-draft plan that would actually work with Christian McCaffrey here.
Okay.
All right. I mean, with Cooper Kupp and Christian McCaffrey as the two guys who are most likely to fall to 6, I mean, you're getting the two guys with the very highest ceilings. And so it just really underlines how valuable it is to get a pick in the top 6 when 5 and 6 might be the best guys.
Any other thoughts here other than CMC guys?
No.
All right, it's, CMC.
It's like the biggest teardrop I can remember in the last several years, right? Like, I mean, Eckler is kind of an interesting little mini tier down, but then you get to the receivers at like 108. I mean, I would just not want to have 108. I get asked a lot, what's your favorite draft slot or whatever, or least favorite? I think my answer is my least favorite is 108 or 109. Like, that's it.
I'm not even as into Eckler at that price. Like, it's, you know, he's another year older. They added firepower at wide receiver. In some ways, I think his amazing season last year was like a symptom of the offense not functioning all that well. Obviously, he played amazing, but I don't know. Whereas McCaffrey, I feel like, is set up really well. I was like looking recently just to go back and see his scoring with the 49ers. And yeah, it was what I wanted to say. at all.
We do see Amon-Ra St. Brown go right after us here. I believe we also have some friends. Our guy Clay, I believe, is from the 1-8. There's also a team in the 12 hole named Chasing Cars. I feel like that might be someone who might be watching this stream, but I don't know who that is.
They're not ship chasing. They're chasing cars. That feels like it's a thing.
It could be. It could be, or it could just be a complete coincidence. Sean, I feel like when we've been drafting on Underdog a bit, you know, we've sometimes taken McCaffrey, but been a little gun shy of just being like, "Are you going to get buried by an avalanche?" I get the impression though, you're still very excited about him, though, especially at this cost.
Yeah, once you get into a 2-2-2 format, it's so dramatically different in terms of what you can do with it and what the downsides are to taking running backs if the running backs are the best value. Because one of the things that we have to think about with any format, that the very max you can play is going to be three running backs, and you have to play at least three receivers, then receiver depth is dramatically important. And then that kind of also influences the easiest and best ways to make sure you're also covering the flex and you're building the depth that you need to handle all of those elements. Whereas if you're getting these great running back values throughout the draft, you have different opportunities to hit those guys, and you can do that. And so if you pass McCaffrey early, there's not a huge penalty for it because you're going to get other options, and getting up to like four elite running back starters is far less valuable. In this format, especially in 2023, one of the things that you're dealing with here that I think is important to, you know, keep in mind is that once Jaylen Waddle and Chris Olave are off the board, the highest scoring player is basically going to be a running back all the way until J.K. Dobbins is off the board. And so there is a big stretch there that you have to be, I think, more flexible in your thinking about how you attack the flex than ever before, where, I mean, zero RB was all about, let's score the most points, let's dominate the flex, let's avoid all of those running back landmines, and let's benefit. And especially, you know, in 2-3-1 formats, where I think for a long time, drafters didn't understand that, I mean, what you could do with the running back position was somewhat limited, but what you could do with wide receivers, this whole idea of let's get six of the top 15 wide receivers. And I was kind of going back through and looking at the years it was possible and thinking about, you know, how those guys are going to be valued. And even thinking about, you know, 2013, sort of the birth of RotoViz and the excellent success for subscribers that year. And one of the reasons is not just loading up on the early guys, but that we had strongly recommended Josh Gordon and Alshon Jeffrey, who went later and had huge seasons. And so you also have to kind of decide, like, who are the guys in that 7, 8, 9, 10 range at wide receiver who are interesting for you and who are going to be able to get the job done and make that 5-round jump that, I mean, obviously when you're rounds 2 and 3, there's a limit to how far the guys can go up, but you want to be thinking, can this guy be a 102, 103 guy next year? After you get a little bit deeper than that, I mean, you're looking for 3-4-round jump guys. And I mean, that part of it is just so fun to like game out all the different scenarios for in 2023.
We've had some interesting picks come off the board. Barkley at 9, Pollard at 11, Bijan falls to 12. The turn drafter also pairs in with AJ Brown. The Pollard drafter grabs Nick Chubb. Then we have Davante Adams, CeeDee Lamb come off the board. The 8 hole with Austin Eckler is on the clock. We are 2 away from picking here. We'll be curious to see what the Austin Eckler drafter does, but already some interesting picks. You don't normally see Barkley go at 9 ahead of guys like Bijan specifically.
And we're seeing Pollard continue to climb, to your point, at 111. It does seem that people were waiting for that Zeke shoe to drop and they're ready to take him at 111 now.
Yeah. Yeah, I think now that we've cleared out the, you know, Zeke not returning to Dallas, I think people are finally starting to get the confidence in him. Although you guys got to check out the Stealing Bananas podcast projecting the second round. I know Sean's not disappointed to see Tony Pollard going this early. Garrett Wilson does come off the board here. We'll see what the Amon-Ra St. Brown drafter does. Were you hoping for Wilson to fall to?
I mean, that would have been ridiculous, right?
Yeah, that would have been fun.
Yeah.
Come on. One more pick here.
See, Sean, there's two players I feel like that you like that are available here. So I feel like we're going to like our selection regardless, but I am curious. So Mark Andrews does go. So that was who you wanted.
That was one of them.
I was hoping that, you know, Mark Andrews is a personal favorite, and then obviously everybody watching has read about him from one, you know, very good legendary upside post. So that's too bad.
That's what I was going to pound the table for. I was very excited at the opportunity to take Andrews. But getting receiver here is nice too.
Yeah.
It's got to be Waddle, right? Jalen Waddle would be the guy for me. Anyone else?
At what point Sean was calling him the best pick of the first round when he wasn't going in the first round?
I think Olave's name should be mentioned, but I prefer Waddle.
Yeah.
Waddle was my pick as next year's 104. So that's probably a little aggressive. I don't think he would be the best pick in the first round right now.
When Sean says he's next year's 104, I just clicked the button. And no more.
We just did the Stealing Bananas episode. Everyone asks us the most about. It's where we predict next year's redraft first round. And there's your spoiler. That Sean had Jalen Waddle at the 104. That's always such a fun exercise.
Sean, how do you see that playing out? Is it because him and Hill stay neck and neck and drafters then just want to bet on the younger guy a year later? Or do you actually see Waddle kind of surpassing Hill as the 1A in that offense?
Yeah, I think that you have potential for Hill to, you know, get dinged up for, you know, one of the things that people, it's so hard when a guy has been that good, just like with Travis Kelce. I mean, but at some point you have a little bit of deterioration, and then at some point you have a lot of deterioration. We're not necessarily predicting that, but one of the things that you look at is that Hill's ability to command targets, and you can see this through a wide variety of different stats, but it's just crazy. And Waddle's ability to command targets was okay. But even with that being the case, Waddle's, you know, yards per route and the other different elements, you look at his ability to get some of those yards after the catch, you look at the ability to put up fantasy points at a level to where if he commands a few more targets or runs more routes, because both of those guys get dinged up and have maybe lower route percentages that people realize. Now it's probably going to stay down compared to other elite receivers, but you have some possibility for him to add some legitimate volume to where people are looking at him and, you know, trying to figure out why he wasn't a top 6 pick in this year's draft. The only thing that can derail him, other than just the avalanche of very ticky-tack injuries that he's always suffering, which I think you have to, you know, be a little bit concerned about, but just if somehow defenses are able to adjust. But I'm a very big believer that this Dolphins offense is going to continue to evolve as well. You've got a great mind there, and they're going to, I mean, they've been the best offense at getting the ball to their playmakers. That's something that I really value when you have a guy who, number one, has done what Waddle has done through 2 seasons, and number two, the speed there, the athleticism there, the things that you can do when you have something that even at the NFL level, very few other people have, it just gives you crazy upside in a young player.
We do see some interesting picks here. Calvin Ridley goes at 2-8 right after us. Jahmyr Gibbs goes at 211 to the Ja'Marr Chase drafter. So, and then the Travis Kelce drafter stacks him up with Patrick Mahomes. But
we're in a loose room like a tonight, room. Boys.
It is loose for sure. Yeah. I am excited to see what falls to us here in the middle of the third round at 3-6. Josh Allen comes off the board. T.J. Hockenson comes off the board.
Jarko, we've seen Jarko before in a lot of these drafts. After stacking KC there, I would have guessed a different position. That's a fun start as well. I mean, we're getting a lot of people doing some fun stuff in this room today.
Jonathan Taylor finally comes off the board at 3-4 to the Tyreek Hill Chris Olave drafter. That seems fun.
That's very fun.
We'll see what the Cooper Kupp Calvin Ridley drafter does here, and then we will be on the clock at 3-6 here. Jalen Hurts is in the top by ADP. We've seen Mahomes and Allen come off the board.
There's nothing else here, right? Like it has.
I think we're right.
I'm preparing that I'm gonna get my heart. No, I'm saying like I don't even know what he could take instead, or he or she.
I see what you're saying.
We're gonna get heartbroken.
It's yeah, Jalen Hurts or
Jalen Hurts. How did that happen?
Sean, do you like T. Higgins here?
Oh, I thought we were talking about Kyle Pitts. No, I'm just kidding.
It seems very obvious that it's T. Higgins. And yet I do want to mention that Ramondre Stevenson now has like maybe the worst running back who's going to have gotten touches in NFL history behind him. So are we not like boosting his projected volume?
It got elevated when Zeke signed.
This is the genius of Sean. He comes in here and he starts a draft saying, you know, we haven't been able to get T. Higgins in the middle of the third round in any format all fucking summer long. Sean says the running back is the best pick at every single juncture after the first round. And then T. Higgins finally falls to us in the third. Your psyops here, Sean, has finally worked.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Well, I'd love to see that Eckler, Barkley, Pollard, Robinson, Chubb run there. Because
yeah,
that starts to get you to think, I mean, some guys are going to fall. And I don't know. I mean, Waddle Higgins as your round one, round two start would actually be fine. And you have Christian McCaffrey on top of that. So I'm pretty excited.
Waddle Higgins at the 1-2 turn.
I think Gretch nailed it. This room is loose. Are having some fun.
This is a fun room.
Yeah.
When I was talking about Jarko taking Hockenson there, I mean, I was saying like we've seen him in a lot of these drafts in the past. Definitely recognize that name. I thought that was going to be Higgins, and then I didn't even really dare to dream. I'm looking at my list, going, who could it be? Pete, you called it. It could be Hurts, but I mean, we couldn't have got Higgins to go one more pick. I don't think. I mean, people don't want to take Ramondre this high right now. That was a fun run out. We don't get a lot of
those. It is nice, right? When you get it's stressful, but you want to get the very last guy in that tier, right? It's like you want there to be one obvious pick every time. And then it hurts when he doesn't get there, but he did.
Yep.
And it just kind of goes back to the 5-6 too, where I mean it could still very easily be the case that we prefer Cooper Kupp when we're another 3 or 4 rounds in. But I mean, now you're kind of looking at it and thinking that Christian McCaffrey being there at 6 could end up being like the massive piece that makes this all work and, you know, creates that $1 million upside.
I was just going to ask you, Sean, 2v2, Cooper Kupp, Ramondre Stevenson, Christian McCaffrey, T. Higgins, which side?
I'm really high on Stevenson. And so I think that's pretty close to a wash. And yet when you think about different scenarios that could play out, I don't know that there's one with Kupp Stevenson to where you're really saying, okay, things change and it's even way better. And certainly we always talk about like the last thing in the world is we ever want is for somebody to get hurt. But with the build that we have, if Ja'Marr Chase does miss some games like he did last year, I mean, that's going to definitely be better than like Cup, Waddle, and Stevenson would be.
And last year he missed some time, but Higgins wasn't right at any point last year. We didn't really see that breakthrough. But like, if you have a healthy Higgins for a stretch with Chase out, like you said, I mean, it's he's a first round pick at that point himself.
Yeah, so right, I didn't know the ADP and wasn't trying to figure out like the cheapest way to get guys, I wouldn't have a huge problem, you know, at least taking some shares of Higgins where AJ Brown and Davante Adams are going.
Right. Yeah. So we take Higgins. The picks following, we get Keenan Allen at 3.7, Debo at 3.8, Metcalf at 3.9. That feels pretty standard. We do get Joe Mixon at 3.10, goes to the Diggs and Adams drafter. The Pollard Chubb drafter takes Jerry Jeudy. And then we see Darren Waller come off the board at 3.12. I mean, people are living a little tonight, guys.
Well, didn't Waller go 3.12 in our first main event too?
I think
our first and our second. I think all three of the ones that we've done.
Yeah,
they've been living all summer, man.
Yeah, the Waller steam is real.
The Waller steam is real.
Ramondre does go to the turn here. So Ramondre goes at 4.1. Feels like a nice pick.
Yeah, that guy's watching. Sean's been talking about him for a half round. He doesn't remember that you can't talk about guys that haven't been drafted yet.
The guy that's
a right, Jason, but I mean, Park. Stevenson wasn't going to come all the way back to us, was he?
You know what? They did this to me last night, Sean. Did this to me last night. They won't admit it. They won't admit that Stevenson wasn't coming. He would have if you didn't talk about him, Sean. He would have
been. We'll never know.
That did the same butterfly thing last effect. Yeah, you never know. He's chasing cars. If we would have started talking about Josh Jacobs, he probably would have taken Josh Jacobs.
Yeah, exactly.
All Sean needed to say was that he's super high on Josh Jacobs, and Josh Jacobs is going to get
a big winner.
Stevenson's still on the board right now. I mean, hang on. The hell?
I'm going to go full screen. Sean, talk about Najee Harris.
So maybe the best way to describe what Najee Harris is currently doing is that the other day, again, just to kind of recalibrate myself, was to look at Jaylen Warren as a college player. And you see that he's a small, slow guy with mediocre peripherals. And then you throw him into the Pittsburgh Steelers offense, and like his advanced stats are crazy. So again, we're talking about a little bit of the contrast that these two players are putting up. I mean, I hope that Harris works out. I think that there are some tiny elements with him in terms of some of the tackle breaking things that are similar to what Josh Jacobs had, where he did eventually break out, but probably a lot more similarities to Trent Richardson, right? To where probably just going to be done. So
my job is done. I got Najee Harris. We lost Breece Hall.
We lost Breece Hall.
We won
the
Najee. The Najee. Oh my award. God. Yeah.
That was the most depressing talk up, pump up speech I've ever heard.
To just pull up out of this like burial of Najee Harris to go, I hope he works out. I hope he works out. Just buries him. I hope it works out. He's probably Trent Richardson though.
I mean, one of the concerns, and I would mention Dave Cabin's breakaway rush score here, and just even at Alabama, when you have these massive holes and you have this elite athleticism, if you're not breaking big plays, then how are you going to do it against NFL defenders? And it's really easy to get tied up in a guy's broken tackle rate and realize that Zach Moss and David Montgomery are, you know, two of the best guys there. But you've got to turn it into yards, which is one of the reasons why athleticism that translates into yards and thus fantasy points and also potentially big plays. When you talk about Jonathan Taylor, some of his peripherals are merely good as opposed to supernatural. But when they're merely good and then there's a hole and you're going to run for 70 yards, that is huge.
I also don't think like people maybe remember that Najee was talked up as like this. He can run wide receiver routes. He's going to be this like receiving weapon and that whole part of his profile. Because the coming out, the lack of explosiveness was regularly cited and was like, I feel like a widely understood red flag on him. It's been as bad as we were worried it would be. But the receiving side just has not materialized in any way. He was inefficient last year as a receiver and as a rookie.
So we're on the clock. The Mark Andrews drafter stacks up Lamar Jackson. We see Josh Jacobs, Christian Watson also come off the board here. Thoughts?
I mean, ETN is the last of a tier of running backs for me. And then there's some tight ends. That's where I'm at. What do you guys think?
I think that's very clear at running back. And yeah, I probably would go to tight end as well.
Jumping out to me here. What do you think, Sean?
I have it as ETN, and then there's, you know, potentially some even options at a different position in the next round, but I am perfectly fine.
So you would prefer ETN, right? Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. I got a little confused as to which ones everybody was saying, but I mean, I just, the numbers on ETN are crazy. Right. And yeah. I mean, he was the guy in the recent article where I talked about there are some Jamal Charles echoes there. And I say echoes as opposed to, you know, some of the fun headlines where you're like, I mean, obviously they're silly, but like the next such and such, because nobody's going to be the next Jamal Charles. He's probably the best pure runner we've ever seen. But I mean, ETN's ability to slash that line to create the big plays, and you go back to what he did in college, but also what he did last year when he probably wasn't 100% in an offense that was still kind of being put together, the variety of upside that you have with him should not be there in the fourth round.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, we were all, I think, in agreement there, so that was good. The chat was saying that the Najee stuff we were saying was like kind of how we were killing Josh Jacobs. I just kind of want to point out that, like, I don't know if we've really discussed this at length. Like, the Josh Jacobs thing was like, I mean, we were wrong about it. Like he hit in multiple ways. We talked about that. Like, one of the really key things about the way that he hit, or if you were on his profile last year, that you kind of have to acknowledge, is you would have been on a lot of profiles that also busted. I mean, there's really no way around that unless you knew specifically what Josh Jacobs had that was unique. But trying to find, to Sean's point about trying to find the next, like, great Jamal Charles, trying to find the next Josh Jacobs by looking at somebody like Najee Harris and saying that he's going to be the next Josh Jacobs, the hit rate for what Josh Jacobs did last year is incredibly low. That's just like,
I also think that's just wrong. It's just, the point is wrong. He doesn't actually look much like Josh Jacobs. Like, if you look at, like, because I went back and looked at some of Josh Jacobs' stuff and was like, you know, he actually rated okay in NFL Next Gen success rate. And like, he was fine in yards per route run. Like, some of the stuff that I regularly cite and look at, like, Jacobs was not bad in. He just wasn't that good. And I bet against him like 3 years in a row, and I was ready to bet against him again. Like, I do think he was a little bit of a blind spot. He wasn't like this amazing profile that I missed, but once he fell into the seventh round or whatever, I should have thought through the bet again, and I didn't really do that. Harris looks like a meaningfully worse bet than Jacobs was last year and is more expensive. So I do not think it's a good idea to go, well, Josh Jacobs hit last year, I can take Harris, because you guys don't know what you're talking about. He could get there on projection. Like, he has a lot of project volume. He could get there. It's not impossible, but I just don't think it's a good bet.
I think you want to do the – oh, go ahead.
Sacrilegious makes a good point. If you want to do it, you got to know ball. I mean, he says, so would you need to buy the next Josh Jacobs? Would you need to know ball? I think so.
I feel like a guy like Cam Akers would be the closer comp to this year's – Josh Jacobs, right? Like, as far as like price and like what he's done before and feeling, you know, yeah, ho-hum about the offensive situation.
Damian Pierce comes to mind. We talked about this.
Yeah.
Like, he was fine last year in the stuff I look at and could be a workhorse. And I'm not excited about the offense and I don't love the player. I don't really want to take a running back there, but he could consolidate all the work and be really good. And he's not going to, I don't think he's going to absolutely like crush in terms of like putting up a legendary season or anything, because I don't think he's that good. But he would be someone where I could see me being like, there were signs and I didn't really take them that seriously.
Well, Jacobs also is somebody who, I mean, he posted a 17% broken tackle rate as a rookie, which is crazy. I mean, it's a ridiculously high number, averaged almost 5 yards per carry. And one of the other big differences, I think, for me is that the Raiders put out a lot of very misleading signs or just breadcrumbs, however you want to talk about it, in terms of what Zamir White was for them last season. With the Steelers, we already know that they are aware that Jaylen Warren is a similar kind of player. So I think that the risk that Najee's going to go out and get all of the work and that is also going to be the thing that kills you, that risk is pretty minimal by comparison.
Yep.
I agree.
Kyle Pitts comes off the board. We are on deck here after the team five picks. You got a couple quarterbacks kicking around here. Burrow, Herbert, Fields, wide receivers. You're in the Terry McLaurin, Deontay Johnson, Brandon Ayuk range here. Anyone else that were interested?
Well, I put a couple names in the chat.
I feel comfortable saying it in this room. JSN is not coming back. So if we want JSN, this is the pick.
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't hate it. I was gonna float Terry McLaurin, Ben, in your piece that I read today, you talked about as a floor pick, and I just wanted to make the case for a ceiling because I think he has one, but he's gone. So I'm good with JSN.
Sean, what do you like? Because I know you got a few different options here.
We definitely don't. I mean, we've talked about him now, so he probably won't come back for sure. I was thinking that either JSN or the tight end here would be the way to go.
Goddard. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, I think we could go Goddard too.
I like Goddard, but I don't know.
He feels rich for Goddard in this range. Yeah.
It's more like he's not like a tight end premium type of boosted play, right? Like he's more like yards after catch, big play type of guy. I don't know.
Sean, JSN or Goddard?
If people are okay with JSN, let's do that.
Yeah, we're very okay with it. We made a mistake last night not getting JSN when we wanted to get him. Let's not make the same mistake tonight.
So I've got our ADP pulled up, which I can look at just the last day, which has like 20 or so drafts in Fantasy Pros main event. And Walker, you know, overall had come back to this spot with him going off at the 4:10. Mm-hmm. I do think it made it a question of, I mean, obviously you're kind of hoping Pitts is going to make it a couple more spots. The only reason that I really do like Goddard right there is I think that like all three of the Eagles pass catchers are rich in some ways, and they have some weaknesses in that. I mean, you're basically banking on some efficiency with all three of them being elite talents in and of themselves. And then also, or at least for the wide receivers, and then Goddard, maybe just a good talent. And then you're banking on that offense. One of the things, and I was there before, and then especially after, you know, reading through Pat's research on the tight ends, I actually don't like hardly any tight ends at all after this. And so yeah, it does. That's the portion of it. I took
myself out of all of them too.
Right, right.
It's like, oh,
but it is interesting. So in my rankings, Sean was kind of, you were joking about this on a recent set of videos. I put these big tier breaks where I think there's a big gap, and I do have one after Goddard. But the way that I have tight end prior to my big tier break is Kelce in his own tier, Andrews in his own tier. And then I have the next four in a tier, and then I have Goddard in his own tier. Because I do have him like this half tier down from this Hawkinson, Waller, Kittle, Pitts range. And then the big tier break, and then everyone else that we're saying, like, we don't really like anyone else. But I do think it's fair to be like, Goddard's not on the same level as the first six. Like, to me, that is how I ranked it, was my point. Like, I do think he's the clear seven in Pat's defense.
Yeah, I think for me, like, from a best ball perspective, I quibble with that, you know, but... Because I think like Waller presents like some real injury risk as this older guy. He seems to be fading a bit, but you're going to feel good about start. Like if he, so once we get to managed, I agree. I actually think Waller is just like a better managed league pick. And you could say a half tier above Goddard for sure. Especially like when you get to tight end premium, like what does Goddard give you? He gives you big plays. He gives you spike week upside and elite offense. He does give you a little bit of contingent value, I think, which is now we could be talking about some tight end premium boost, but yeah, I don't mind that at all.
I do want to talk about this because I'm surprised at the chat. So people saying JSN over Ayuk is insane. Then they say, I like JSN, but he could be the third to start in Seattle. I mean, isn't Ayuk, I mean, we all like Ayuk, but I mean, he could legitimately be the fourth option in San Francisco's offense behind CMC, Debo, and Kittle. Like, I don't actually think it's that different.
I also really like Ayuk, but I think when you're taking him in this range, you're buying into the real drum beat that's there, and it is a valid, you know, I think it's the legit drum beat. It's like the only like camp stuff that I'm like the chain, like adjusting the ranks on, to steal the Denny Carter thing. But it's a legit, like, Brandon Ayuk is getting the types of reports that you think he's about ready to absolutely take off and ascend into another level. But part of that, part of the ways that that happens are if things don't consolidate, or I mean, if things are like opening up in San Francisco in some way, either Debo's not playing particularly well, or Kittle misses time, which he does often, or Christian McCaffrey misses time. And we have McCaffrey already, and we're already kind of saying that McCaffrey's going to be this legendary RB1. And I don't think in the scenarios where McCaffrey is a superstar running back, I'm not saying that you can't stack them together, but I'm not like crazy about Ayuk at this price on a McCaffrey build.
The other thing, the difference between JSN and Ayuk is I think what's in front of JSN is far more surmountable than what's in front of Ayuk. You know, like I don't think JSN closing out the year as the top dog on Seattle is an insane take. I think it's probably fairly realistic, where I don't know if Ayuk can do that in San Francisco. I think that's all four of those for me.
Yeah. All four of those 49ers are better than DK Metcalf and Tyler Lockett.
Yeah, exactly.
And I think the thing that Ayuk's going to battle is that they don't really want to have someone emerge as like this target dominator. Like, this is a team that wants to be able to attack you different ways, wants to keep you off balance, wants you to think you know what they're doing and then punch you from the other direction. So I guess I like Ayuk, and I take Ayuk over JSN in best ball most of the time, but I don't think it's outrageous at all to take a guy who can offer you elite target dominant upside down the stretch. I mean, and that's what JSN I think offers us. Like, he could just be open constantly in the short and intermediate areas of the field. And we know Geno Smith is hyper accurate to those areas. Like, it doesn't even have to be that he's better than anyone. It's just that he's open where his quarterback likes to throw the ball. And that's the case on almost every play. That's going to draw a lot of targets.
So some of the picks that have come in off the board. So JSN we took, then Ayuk, Christian Kirk, Deontay Johnson, Joe Burrow, Chris Godwin. Goddard does go to the turn team, also the Waller drafter, then James Cook, then Addison, Alexander Mattison to the Joe Mixon, Najee Harris team. Justin Herbert goes to an unstacked team out of the nine hole. Marquise Brown comes off the board at eight. We are on deck right now. Definitely some interesting names. The chat is very excited about Justin Fields falling this far. We'll see if the Lamar Jackson owner would double tap. Do you guys have interest in Justin Fields at 6'7"?
Well, I wrote him up as the best pick in whatever round he was going in this format. And so I do like him there, but I just have a hard time when I'm actually playing the leagues myself, burning a pick at QB when there are such tantalizing other options.
And so,
is anyone tantalizing you right now, Sean?
Yeah, it's J.K. Dobbins that's tantalizing Sean.
I do like Dobbins here. I think Dobbins is a stealth candidate to go for 2,000 yards.
Let's take Dobbins. What are we doing? Take him.
I can't wait. Chat, you're gonna have fun with this.
That is so bad. I didn't realize that we were counting down as well, but not from Fields.
The chat was getting too comfortable with liking our team. It was time to go full heel.
Dobbins
on
over Fields is nuts. No.
Enjoy it.
Here and next. That is
the funny amazing thing is, if they knew some of the things we were discussing before the show with this team, the entire chat's brains would just like implode and just melt onto the floor, which is so beautiful.
The chat also has not moved from best ball season yet, I don't think, guys. It's still really early in the main event season. I saw a comment on James Cook going 601. FYI, guys, that's his ADP now in high stakes. He's going there. When I just looked it up the other day when I was writing up my RB tiers article, the highest he's gone in a main event, and there hasn't been a ton yet, is 501. His average, I think his ADP was like right at 60, if I'm not misremembering that. That's like literally where he goes. Like, if you want to get James Cook in a main event, that's where you take him. You might get him to fall a little bit. But to get Dobbins after him, to get Dobbins after Madison and White, like, whew, feels pretty good.
Yeah. Yeah, people are spooked on Dobbins. Even I mentioned to you guys, I've been doing a bunch of the weekly winners drafts, and guys like James Cook and Madison, they're all going ahead of Dobbins in that format too. Just people in general are very spooked about Dobbins right now.
Yeah,
but I'm a little disappointed that we only have one player so far who's either injured or holding in. I thought we might, you know, already be up to like three. So.
Yeah.
I mean, Taylor and Breece, I would have loved to have if they fell a little further.
Yeah.
I mean,
Fields does go two picks after us, by the way, for the people. Team four, Sex Panther, has a pretty fun team here. Tyreek Hill, Chris Olave, Jonathan Taylor, Amari Cooper. But then Kyle Pitts and Justin Fields is a nice team.
Totally redeemed yourself.
Mm.
You know, the thing with like J.K. Dobbins, right? He goes one pick ahead of David Montgomery. Like, I mean, you know, this is kind of my thing, but like don't play running back as like a floor play, like swing for the fences at running back. Like Dobbins, what if Dobbins is just holding in, is completely healthy and is going to like be back with the Ravens offense pretty soon, and the Ravens take a step forward. I expect all of those things to happen. I think none of them are guaranteed to happen, and I'm creating a little parlay, but I feel like I'm stringing together some favorites, and it actually pays out pretty good, that ticket. So I mean, I don't know, Dobbins feels like a guy normally, I don't know, 2-3 years ago would have been a third or fourth round pick, when without the Holden stuff, but we'd be like, oh man, that's so pricey. Get him in the
The funny thing is that Chad doesn't realize if Ramondre Stevenson and Kenneth Walker were available at certain junctures, we might have five running backs through six rounds right now.
Right.
They don't realize.
That's the plan you alluded to. You guys don't even know what was about to happen.
Yeah. Sean, how do you feel about this start? Christian McCaffrey, Jalen Waddle, T. Higgins, Travis Etienne, JSN, J.K. Dobbins. I feel like right there's probably like 40,000 words you've written about those players this offseason.
Yeah, it's so much fun. And it's so much fun to come on with you guys and draft them. I've got some drafts going right now that look pretty good, but I don't know if any of them compare to this.
It's pretty fun. We are seeing a run here of running backs. Javonte Williams goes to the one hole here. They also grab up Kamara. Then we see Miles Sanders come off the board. Damian Pierce. We're back to the Fields and Pitts drafter. The team, the chat is lustfully staring at here during this draft. Definitely some interesting names though for us here in the seventh round as Michael Pittman comes off the clock.
We got a guy on the board that was in Sean's 2024 second round. That is one of my next best players at a position.
I also have to say that from following the drafts and reading the newsletters, it's probably time to start throwing Evan Ingram out there as a possibility.
That's the one guy Pat Corrin will not let us draft around here. He refuses to let us draft him. Even
it's
as
such a good mood. Why would you do this?
Yeah.
Oh, this is a dark storm cloud just came over.
Yeah. We had to wait to select Greg Dulcich, Adam Troutman's backup instead, is what we had to do.
Well, I'm so sorry that we have Jordan Addison on our team, guys. I'm just going to have to apologize all season, I think, about that.
Yeah, exactly. All right, five-hole bleeding out the clock here.
Oh, there it is. That's back.
Sean has me hyped on George Pickens. Is there anyone else you guys would like to take here?
I think to me it's kind of flat here. There's a few other wide receivers who I would be interested in the queue, but I don't feel strongly. So if you guys strongly prefer Pickens, I'm good with it.
That was who Sean ranked in the second round that I was referring to, but there's actually another guy that you ranked in the second round that's here too, and another guy that I know he likes just as much as those guys. Sean, who is it going to be? You got the four. I agree with that.
I like Pickens. I think some of the things that they did last season artificially deflated his ability to command targets. Now, it's always been a little bit of an issue even stretching back, obviously, I think you could make the case that in some ways, even his really impressive season as a rookie in the SEC, but with how dominant he's been in their camp, with Deontay Johnson and some of the other players there also being able to challenge defenses, and with the big play ability and, I mean, the contested catch ability is unreal. And you also have a guy here who seems already sort of beloved by his teammates, by his quarterback, and probably has one of the best personalities in the NFL. And I do think that that kind of thing...
Hang on, Sean.
You know, are you, it's going to be tiny. That I read a fantastic article on The Ringer, I think by Kevin Clark, about him. And just the fact that this dude like goes out of his way on every single play, regardless of if he's involved in the play, not involved in the play. I mean, he loves to talk about his blocking, which I have no idea is even good or not. But he goes out of his way every play to be weird. And sometimes to run the routes incorrectly because he thinks the defensive back is going to be very – is going to execute his own plan well on some of those routes. And so if you blow your route, the defender's not going to know what you're doing. Now, I mean, some of these things you could argue maybe aren't the thing you actually want.
This sounds like a big old Gallagher brain idea to me, yeah.
But – I mean, Pickens is, I mean, he's a crazy, weird, fun dude who also happens to be just a fantastic football player, stretching back a long time. And I mean, to be able to get him in the seventh round is only possible because he had serious injuries in college, and maybe because he is weird. And that's turned off, you know, some people who let him fall to like the 50th pick of the reality draft. So, yeah, I mean, I do think there's a little bit of risk with Pickens that he just gets buried by Deontay Johnson, like, being up there and leading the NFL in targets. But even then, I think you got a decent floor, and the ceiling is just, it's so much fun, and it's really, really high.
Yeah. I feel like, Sean, you might look at George Pickens and you might see a very simpatico, you know, personality. Sean, you're willing to get weird in drafts. George Pickens willing to get weird while running his routes. I feel like you guys might be on the same wavelength.
It definitely feels good to have him on the team.
So our team here through seven rounds, I fucking love this team. CMC, Jalen Waddle, T. Higgins, Travis Etienne, JSN, J.K. Dobbins, George Pickens. This is a super fun team. Pat, how are you feeling?
I'm feeling good. So my concern with Pickens is the route running. He didn't really get open last year, and that's based on reception perception and ESPN open score. I might be overstating the reception perception, but he was saying Matt Harmon had him as a long-term starting X receiver, but was saying he thought we needed to pump the brakes a bit on his ceiling. And in open score, he didn't rate very well. It wasn't terrible. He's actually rated right next to Mike Williams, which I kind of think is fitting, right? Like, it's like probably not going to get open that well, but he's going to make those fun catches with the long arms and everything, and got amazing hands and all that. But that's the part that concerns me a little bit, especially next to Deontay Johnson. So I've been mixing him in the seventh, but he hasn't been a huge target for me there. I don't want to mention anyone else in case they went. Oh, I was going to actually float Mike Evans, although he's less fun. And then Dotson was the other guy that I thought would be pretty interesting. But again, I think it is flat, and I certainly like the idea that you're getting Pickens now, you know, several years removed from the ACL. Maybe the offense takes a step forward. Deontay, he gets open, but he doesn't really do much other than that. Like, maybe they just, you know, move Pickens up in sort of the play calling hierarchy. We see for more first reads. So I think as an upside swing, it's a good one.
I think it can be a real trap to get like too hung up in what team observers are saying. Because, I mean, often that stuff is actually already priced in or already factored into how fantasy analysts are thinking about it. And then if you factor it in again, you're double counting in a way that then starts to lead you in the wrong direction. But kind of building off what Pat just said there, a lot of people, you know, in and around the Steelers think that that target gap between those two guys is going to come down dramatically. And if it did, then, I mean, Pickens would be in great shape. I also love Dotson, and he's somebody I draft ahead of Pickens depending on the situation. His ADP here suggested to it to us that like there was at least a slight chance he would come back, but obviously didn't.
So we took Pickens, the picks that came off the board after Cam Akers, Trevor Lawrence, DeAndre Swift, Michael Thomas, Jahan Dotson, who we were mentioning was probably in the conversation there as well. Mike Evans and Cortland Sutton go at the turn to the 12 team. Zay Flowers, then Dalvin Cook, Isaiah Pacheco were up in two picks. We'll see what the Trevor Lawrence drafter does here. Looking at the top of the queue here, you see names like James Conner, Pat Freiermuth, Deshaun Watson, Brandon Cooks, Antonio Gibson. We'll see what comes back to us here in the eighth round as we have four wide receivers, three running backs, no quarterbacks, no tight ends, no kicker, no defense, no Justin Tucker quite yet, guys.
I will say on the, just to close out the Pickens thing, like if one of him or Dotson is just going to like take over the offense, to me, it is Pickens. I think that's the way. Like, I just think he has the higher upside of like, because he can get downfield in a way that Johnson's just not going to be able to do. And if he ends up being the number one receiver and their primary downfield threat, and he can separate a bit better as a second year player, which wouldn't be shocking, then yeah, he definitely feels like the bigger swing. So I'm glad we went that way.
The chat is just me and Pete talking about options. I don't think he, Pat or Sean has looked at it, but we're talking about a guy in MTV because wants to look at it.
So Elijah Moore goes, I was like, running back has been pretty wiped out here. What are you guys seeing?
I like the player you have in the queue. I do think there's a slight chance he could come back, but probably won't. And with the build that we have, I think he's the most fun way to play it. I was going to float Elijah Moore, but then he does go, you know, you can start looking at Chiefs receivers in this range.
Gretch, Pat, any other thoughts?
I don't know who's in the queue.
Quentin Johnston.
Is in the queue.
That would be my preference. Just swing.
We're all in lockstep. Then Quentin Johnston.
John, you think there is a chance he comes all the way back to 906? You're saying. I think you're crazy.
Well, I mean, gonna happen. If we passed on him there, I'm seeing in the last day that he's going at 903, and wow. I mean, you could start to throw in like, man, that dude. Like he dropped so many passes and like he let a couple of them get into his body. Like he let him get into his body. You can't, I mean, you can't take the guy who's going to lead.
His body!
You can't take the guy who's going to lead the Chargers in targets if he lets some of those targets get into his body. Come on.
Wait, Sean.
Sean, how many players, because you guys, Ben referenced it, you guys just did your podcast on projecting the 2024 first two rounds. How many players have we selected from those two rounds collectively from you guys?
Everyone, well, the funny thing is, yeah, the my 2,000 yard rusher is the only one who wasn't in that group.
That's why it's stealth, Sean. That's why it's the
that
stealth.
Is why it's stealth. It's stealth.
Yeah.
PJ was his 212. Wow. Yeah. That's incredible. You're 104 and you're 106, and neither of those is McCaffrey. Oh man, that's great.
Yeah, where did you guys have McCaffrey? Did you have him out?
Late first. Sean might have had him 201. I had him like 111.
Okay.
Yeah, we both put Cup, McCaffrey, and Tyreek back to back to back. I think I had it 9-10-11, and he had it 11-12-201, if I remember right.
Well, now that I have an emotional connection to him that's greater here, I'm gonna move him up three or four spots. But yeah, I think it's just with that workload split in San Francisco, you get a year older. If he does get any dings, which we hope he doesn't do, and then, I mean, you're starting to even really good players who have hung on. Like, I mean, Dalvin Cook is actually a lot better, I think, than at least the Vikings realize. Alvin Kamara could still do some things, but and Christian McCaffrey is a lot better than those guys. I would love for him to have a Marshall Faulk type of. I mean, but yeah, I mean, you start to get to that range, I think. And one of the things too, is that you put a guy who's kind of a running back and is in that age range at the 1-2 turn, it's actually a really positive sign for him. in terms of what you think he's going to accomplish this season. For the reasons that, you know, Pat just mentioned, you know, he might even be a little bit lower on Austin Eckler right here. I mean, Eckler is coming off a tournament winning season, and he's still a little bit tough in that range.
Are you still kind of in on Dalvin Cook? Is that what you're saying?
Well, if we look at Aaron Rodgers' running backs and how that whole thing could be set, and I do have a little bit of concern about what the Jets might do, but I think it is an offense that could generate a lot of total EP to the running backs. And I think that, I mean, one of the things that is interesting, I think, for Stevenson is that Elliott could be so bad that it helps Stevenson's volume. Cook could be so good that it keeps a lot of those drives going to where the Jets become this scoring machine. And if you have the guy who's basically now just soaking up the Carter Knight Abanikanda touches and does it in a very efficient way, I mean, you could see that as a rising tide kind of lifting all boats within that offense and letting those guys score. That being said, I'm not comfortable with the price on Cook. I think that with him not actually being healthy and being, you know, in all likelihood, Breece's backup, this feels a little bit rich.
Yeah, Dalvin Cook goes at 8-3 in this draft. Breece Hall goes at 4-2. After we took QJ, we get Khalil Herbert, Sky Moore, roll the clip, James Conner, Kadarius Toney, and then the one-hole double taps, Deshaun Watson, David Njoku. Also want to mention, we got a bunch of you guys watching here. If this is your first time to the Ship Chasing YouTube, we are drafting all of our high stakes leagues here down the home stretch. Get subscribed next week. Our programming schedule on Wednesday night, we are drafting an NFFC primetime high stakes draft with our guys, the Buckeye Boomers from the Ship Chasing Discord. And then a week from tonight at 10 p.m., same time as tonight, with the legend Crack Rock, we will be drafting an FFPC main event team. It is time to get all of the inside sources and figure out why he was wrong about Dalvin Cook not siding with the Jets. So we'll get that. Well, he wasn't
completely wrong, right? Like he did leave, and they, you know, but then he did sign. So he was ultimately wrong, but he looked like he looked a little less wrong than he could have looked.
Yeah. So that'll be next week here. Also, if you guys are enjoying this FFPC main event, we did just wrap up our first slow main event draft that we hopped in probably a couple weeks ago. We recorded an OTC mini series where we hopped on the clock for a lot of our decision points. Those videos are available for YouTube members. If you guys become a YouTube member, $4.99 a month gets you access to our private Discord as well as that premium content. I also do Best Ball After Dark series that are available to YouTube members as well. So pretty good bang for your buck there at $4.99 a month. I'm going to be doing one with Eric Beim for tomorrow afternoon if you guys are YouTube members. And we are about to be on the clock.
I'll also say, if you want to listen to the first couple episodes, I think the first three are out. But it's kind of like, you know, it's like if you want to binge it, you know, I got you hooked with the three eps and you're looking to finish up the series. Subscribe and you can watch the videos. Crank out all the episodes at once.
It is true. Yeah, we got the podcast feed. All of our episodes pop up there as well. 9:05 is on the clock. We are on deck here. Our team, CMC, Jalen Waddle, T. Higgins, Travis Etienne, JSN, J.K. Dobbins, George Pickens, Quentin Johnston. Sean, any thoughts here about this ninth round pick?
Well, among the sort of positions that we're talking about, I do have a pretty strong preference for the wide receiver. And one of the things I kind of pitched to you guys before the show was that maybe running back paths were going to give us this extreme upside for filling the flex. And yet this particular draft, I think, has given us some names and some guys that in a more traditional, I mean, obviously this isn't a zero RB draft, but stylistically, there are some things that we've been able to accomplish that if we do hit the one more guy here, I think it gives us just massive upside.
Does the name rhyme with smirks?
It does.
With a smirk.
But we do have an interesting series of considerations.
Sorry. No. Gretch. I should have built some drama.
I mean, Gretch. He said, does it rhyme with smirks? And Sean said, it does. It's over. If you wanted someone else, you had to speak up before that.
I had like 47 comments in our private chat about his pick. And it just was, does it rhyme with Smirks? And then B click yes on 50 seconds left to go. All right. That's fine. I think we were going to come back around to it anyway.
Probably going to go with Perks no matter what. But you never got to say your piece.
He was a key part of the discussion. So yeah.
Well, I do think the other guy that we're really looking at there, I think there's a really strong chance he comes back. So from that perspective.
That was one of them there. Pat Freiermuth, I think, is kind of the last of a group. But there's some interesting ways to play tight end later. I don't think we had to go there. Probably would have been my third choice.
Talk about Freiermuth, because he's a guy I've been drafting a lot. Sean, you were talking a little bit about Darnell Washington. I was looking into some of the stuff about Darnell Washington, who's having an incredible camp, getting some rave reviews. I could notice a little bit of trepidation in your voice on Monday's or Wednesday's Best Ball Breakfast, specifically about Darnell Washington. Is that changing the Freiermuth thesis a little bit for you?
It is for me, because and again, wrapping in with some of the notes that Pat had on him, but I think that Freiermuth is like the next guy who has that TJ Hockenson breakout potential. And yet, maybe the quarterback play doesn't help you quite as much. I think for me too, I tend to draft Freiermuth, a lot in best ball when I have JSN and he's the last way to put that together. I probably don't prefer to play him maybe as much when I already have a Steelers receiver. But the other thing that just, again, with that Washington deal is that, I think he was the guy who really surprisingly in the draft became a little bit less of a priority than players who just aren't good, or, at least have to outperform their profiles to justify where they were picked. And Washington looks like he's going to be a massive steal for them. And I don't think that stops. If Freiermuth is good, if he's the next guy to make the leap, then Washington's not going to be a problem. But if he's a little bit down, or if the offense does do the thing where they lean into their running backs who aren't good, then at this price, probably there are other better options.
That's the exact comp that I've been making sort of the whole offseason. And that Hockenson, but for Freiermuth to do that sort of requires Pete, I'm going to share this yards per route run lookup thing I have. Will you pull this up really quick?
Yeah.
So this is yards per route run, routes, yards per target, targets per route run, the weighted targets per route run. And then on the far right, you have the percentages of pass blocking, slot, wide, inline, etc. Main thing is Hockenson is rookie year in 2019, lower yards per out run, had a 19.5% targets per out run, literally the same as Freiermuth's rookie season, similar A dots, especially where Freiermuth was in his second year at 8.4. And Freiermuth took a similar step forward in targets per out run. But the big number for Freiermuth is those routes, 395 in his rookie year, 435 last year. Hockenson last year finally got to 573 routes there. His yards per out run still in that same range that Freiermuth was in. Actually, Freiermuth last year's yards per out run better than all of Hockenson's career years. But you see how it's a really similar profile from the year one to year two leap that Freiermuth did. Freiermuth's TDs fell off last year, and that's the thing that could actually bounce back in his favor. But I think this comp is really interesting, but I also think you guys are making a great point, and Pat also made a great point in his article, and I moved Freiermuth down a significant tier break in my rankings after reading Pat's write-up about Darnell Washington, about the run block snaps, because that routes number is really the key for whether or not Freiermuth can be Hockenson.
Yeah, and I'll note that Washington, I believe, also fell in the draft due to some injury concerns that, don't seem to be a big deal now. He's crushing in camp. So, it's one of those things where maybe they were being prudent to discount him a little bit, but it doesn't – whatever those concerns were do not appear to be manifesting with any issues so far. And he is just a massive dude. he is going to crush as a run blocker, I think. We can count on that. And yeah, my whole article is basically just pointing out that, the guys who crushes run blockers are usually out there when they fake the run too, and play action snaps and play action routes more specifically are actually really valuable for tight ends, especially for touchdown production. And that's another thing where you look at Washington, he's 6'7". He's out there blocking in goal line sets. Like, is it going to be him or is it going to be Freiermuth who benefits from play action stuff at the goal line if he has a meaningful role? You know, it just starts to make you a little bit worried. But I still do like Freiermuth. I don't want to be out because I think he does have that Hockenson kind of breakout profile. I agree with that.
So we got a lot of running backs come off the board. We also, after Freiermuth, you saw Kincaid and Higbee and Schultz go. The running backs, we saw Charbonnet, Jamal Williams, Jalen Warren, Samaje Perine, Tank Bigsby, Rashad Penny. We are on deck here. We're going to see what the seven hole does. Definitely some interesting names here for us, depending on how we play it. We still have no tight ends on our team. Every team on the backside of this board has already selected at least one tight end. Devon Achane comes off the board. I had earmarked him.
Yeah.
What do you guys think?
I kind of like Sean's tight end at this point.
Get our first tight end.
In the chat. What do you...
I would lean quarterback here, but I'm open to the tight end for sure.
There's no reason to do quarterback here. None. I wrote it out in the chat. There's no way. Every single team behind us already has a quarterback. No one's sniping quarterback here. Right. Is it Sean? Who do you like here as far as running back or wide receiver or tight end?
Well, I don't think the exciting tight end comes back. So if we want him, I think we have to take him. I also just like stashing Jameson Williams, but
I strongly prefer the tight end, if you guys are good with that.
I strongly prefer the tight end, too. Sean, I don't know what you're doing with Jameson Williams, but the camp reports are – there's never been a player with worse vibes in the history of football.
You just talked of George Pickens' vibes and personality, and we're going to take Jameson Williams?
I'm very concerned about the Jameson Williams vibes, man. He would have brought down the excitement of this squad.
So we don't want the locker room presence is what I'm getting here?
Yeah, that's the concern for sure.
Yeah.
So, Sean, talk about
– he's not going to play the rest of the preseason now with the hamstring. That came out today. Like, he's not even going to get reps before he's suspended when he needed to get some reps in. He's going to come back
and play. That's fine. His coach doesn't think he has terrible hands, right? So that's not
a problem. So. He also only ran him on, like, 10 routes a game to end the season last year when he was
healthy. Let's talk about Sam LaPorta. Am I the only one who
has more than one career reception, though, right? Definitely.
No, actually, he doesn't.
I'm the only one who knows how to do this. Sean, talk about Sam LaPorta.
Well, I mean, LaPorta was one of these guys where once you get into all of that prospect stuff, it was really interesting because you have someone who, you know, is productive. He has some of those, you know, after the catch types of things. I mean, he's the next guy, right, to be a superstar. And Dalton Kincaid, because of the Buffalo Bills connection, has been pushed up. And I'm not saying that that won't also work out. I mean, you could get multiple guys from this draft. But, I mean, LaPorta is the far opposite end of the spectrum from the jokes we've got going with Williams here, where the Detroit Lions absolutely love him. They drafted him because they think that he is the guy who beats this type of, you know, evolving defense that you're going to face all year long. They think that Sam LaPorta is basically the defense breaker. And I mean, Sam LaPorta is also a freak athlete, right? You've got him training people like George Kittle who are saying, I mean, like, this guy is unstoppable. He's unbelievable. Now, I mean, some of those quotes you get from the players are going to be like some of the quotes you get from me, where occasionally there's a tad bit of hyperbole in there, but there are so many things that are pointing in the same direction for Sam LaPorta that, you know, when you have a shot here, I mean, the thing I'd be concerned about is just you're taking a rookie tight end for your first tight end. So you're probably going to have to continue to make some, you know, build some other contingencies in as you go along, which isn't the most comfortable thing when we've already sort of said we don't like the tight ends going forward. But I mean, LaPorta, he could be so good. And especially if Williams is not going to factor in all season. I mean, you're talking about an offense that's going to be Amon-Ra, LaPorta, and Gibbs, and all three of those guys are going to be absolutely electric.
Yeah, to me, it's like once you see Higbee and Schultz come off the board, I mean, it's LaPorta feels like a slam dunk. I mean, do you think his ADP could rise even more? I mean, everything out of camp sounds incredible. There's no reason, like, I don't know what's stopping the LaPorta hype at this point.
Well, it feels Waller-esque in a sense. It's like, you know, you just keep hearing like they have a plan to use this guy a lot. And he's, you know, with Waller, it's, I think, maybe people kind of recovering from the injury stuff a little bit. But also just like the drumbeat of this dude's their number one receiver. We're not hearing that with Laporta, but he is immediately cemented himself as their starting tight end. Like, right, to me, like, one of the reasons what worried about rookie tight ends is that it takes them a while usually to work into a full-time role. But if Laporta's in a full-time role out of the gate, I mean, that's very bullish. And I think people will eventually kind of start to push him up and start drafting him like he's a starting tight end. I mean, maybe not a ton more than this, but I don't see any reason why you couldn't take him ahead of Higbee.
Right. I mean, for sure.
So
yeah, that's easy.
Outside
the question
of,
is could he flip Kincaid and Freiermuth?
I think here's a take. I think in managed league like this, he probably should flip Kincaid.
Yeah.
I like that.
He's gonna be an easier weekly start than Kincaid.
He's gonna be an easier weekly start than Kincaid. Sure. Yes.
Yeah. Separate from my drafts with Pete, I am up to, I think, 52 BBMs. And so I'm like a third of the way there or whatever it is.
I thought you were going to say 52% Laporta. Sorry, go ahead.
I'm at 37.5. Is that
close? That's where we're headed.
Yeah.
Wow.
Jesus.
I need to get more Laporta.
Yeah.
I've had too. So much Laporta pre-draft. I'm at 14.5% Laporta. So I feel real shame right now.
I need to slide some of my Dulcich exposure over to
Laporta. Yeah, let's see if Underdog will take some trade-ins.
I had to slide Dulcich way down my ranks.
That was a shame. Yeah.
This feels like the point of the show where Sean makes an impassioned case for Dulcich at 11. So the picks since we took Laporta, Gainwell, the chat was reacting to, now going at 10-8, McKinnon 10-9, Dubs, Juju, Tyler Boyd, Zay Jones, Roshan at 11-2, Odell 11-3, Tajay Spears, a guy we all like, at 11-4. We are on deck. We'll see what the Gainwell drafter does here. Sean, are you, you want to build out a Lions bet here if he makes it back?
Well, not now. I mean, I'm starting to worry that Williams is going to be dropping passes for the rest of our guys. So,
yeah.
I mean, I have a rule on this show. If someone makes a case for a guy and he comes back, you know, 12 picks later, you take that guy. That's just
my the case for Tua.
We don't have any interest in Jameson Williams. Like, I couldn't be less interested in taking Jameson
Williams. I love that you were like, don't talk about him. And me and Pat were like, we're trying to get him picked.
Like, no,
we're doing a bad job of it.
Who are you guys worried about taking Tua? The 11-hole
Tua? Oh, there he goes!
But we're still not taking Tua here.
Dude, Tua's the pick. He's past ADP, and he's stacked with our number one wide receiver.
What do you mean past ADP? We've taken Tua in two straight main event drafts in the 11th round. This is where he goes. This isn't past ADP. This is where he goes.
It is literally past ADP. His ADP is at 10-10.
You've gotten him twice in the 11th round.
The 11th round.
Sean, tell the people that there's a better pick.
Well, he's the only guy currently in the queue. The players that I would push for here over him, I think, can be drafted later. And I do actually think that Tua, just separate from ADP, is the most undervalued quarterback by a country mile. So I guess I would probably prefer not to risk the guy who doesn't have a QB taking him.
Yeah.
Now we have 100% exposure to Tua in made of it. It's so afraid of
concussions, and it's fair.
I'm not afraid of concussions. I legit think we could have gotten him at 12-7. Full stop.
I mean, who's maybe, taking but like, I don't know.
The opportunity cost wasn't like what did we pass up?
No one else.
Damian Harris is the next best running back on my board. Did you want me to do another Damian Harris?
Well, your board is a lot different than everyone else's board who doesn't have Damian Harris there. I honestly would have rather have taken Dulcich or Algier or I legit think you can push quarterbacks in these rooms. Like, look at the board here. The Zay Flowers.
Did. Yeah, we did.
We already pushed him five rounds behind.
You guys are acting like this is after ADP. We've gotten Tua in two main events at this exact same spot. This is where he goes.
We've gotten him. I mean, ADP is like literally a thing, and it's ADP Pat, is in the 10th round. I don't know what you're saying.
Pat, listen to this.
What are you actually saying? Because he has a 10th round.
We don't have him stacked with Waddle yet. This is our first Waddle.
Are you saying that the two drafts that we got are more powerful signal than the average of all drafts? Because that's fucking nuts.
The Tyreek Hill drafter is behind us. There is no candidate. Pat, how many drafts have you done on Underdog where Tua falls because people do not want to take Tua unstacked?
Yeah, but
no one is taking. We have Waddle in the Hill drafter is behind us. It's not happening. There's one team on the board who doesn't have a QB.
You're probably right that we could have gotten Tua in the 12th round, but there's no one that was even floated that like makes it move a little. Like I don't even
two players.
What's the point? I know, but I'm not. I don't know. It just felt like it feels to me like you're getting cute a little bit if you're saying the room can't do something stupid, and you're doing it to facilitate something you're not even that excited about. Where it's just like, hey, you know, at this point, guys, 10 picks after ADP or whatever, let's grab them and stack them up, and that's a nice pick for us. And I don't know, the guy we get next round will probably be pretty similar to the guy we could have gotten instead.
I do think running back gets wiped out here really quickly. That's the one I would buy.
The Dulcich one, I don't see. The Dulcich one, he's got to have fallen into a tier that stretches back for rounds. But I think you can make a case that we could have went running back. I think I'll agree with that. Damon Harris was there. I mean, we're all looking for the guy who wanted to grab Damon Harris.
I think there's something to that argument. But we're strong at running back. I'm just, you know, it's like, you know, let's just.
I'll give you guys one here. So the team from the 10 hole took Dak Prescott. So he definitely could have gone. But I also think we could have pushed it.
We could have pushed it. And I'd have been down to push it if.
That guy has three receivers, six running backs, and just took his QB2. That's the other part about shit. You can push into these rooms, but also you get crazy stuff in these rooms.
Yeah, it just would have really stung in my mind if we lost him for something that we're like, I don't even give a shit that we took that guy. You know?
I will say this, though. The guy who takes Dak Prescott as his second QB with three wide receivers, he thinks that Tua's getting a concussion in week two and is never going to see him. I'll tell you that.
Thinks he's not tough enough, for sure. He thinks the concussions are a sign of like his weakness as a human being.
Exactly. I do agree with you that it was flat. Like I wish I had someone to run to the podium just so I didn't have that guy.
I get it. If you had that guy, then I would have felt sick to my stomach, but we probably just take that guy.
Well, because in our slow main event draft that we're doing with the slow bros, Jaylen Warren almost made it. And we were in a similar spot where we had Tyreek Hill. And I was going to push for Jaylen Warren over two in that spot. Jaylen Warren goes one pick before. We didn't have a Jaylen Warren pick here. So
Right. That's the key, I think.
Yeah.
I would say that if there was a guy, Rashee Rice would probably be it for me. I was hoping that he would come back to us for the 12th round there. I do think he would be a lot more expensive if Sky Moore hadn't busted last year. They're different. He's like this discount Quentin Johnston, and that would be fun with Patrick Mahomes. So I think that was a good pick by the drafter there at the turn.
Let's recap this team through 11 rounds. So we got our running backs are CMC, Travis Etienne, and J.K. Dobbins. Our wide receivers, Jalen Waddle, T. Higgins, JSN, George Pickens, Quentin Johnston, Treylon Burks. And then we just grabbed our first tight end, Sam Laporta, and our first quarterback, Tua, here. Still loving this team, though. Casey Brink likes it. This draft is fire. These guys know ball. Casey Brink didn't say that, but I was just imagining that.
That's what he means. That's what he really means.
Know ball. Yeah.
I'm a little mad he didn't say that now.
Sean, let me ask you a question. Do you know ball?
No.
We have a lot of moments. We need to... You know, it's been a couple years since we've updated the ship chasing reel, and there's a couple moments we need to bookmark tonight.
I used to try to get Sean to say he's a piss boy. Now I just tried to get him to say he knows ball.
Holy shit.
Excuse me.
Oh, wow. And we're getting a Gretsch burp. Now we're really cooking.
Damon Harris went. I was pouring one out for Damon Harris.
Gretsch wrote 6,000 words in our private chat about Damon Harris, and now he's off the
board. No, he doesn't want him ever.
All right,
that's the guy I actually put in our private chat was Mostert.
Mostert
comes off the board. Eli Mitchell, Gerald Everett, Damian Harris, Zamir White, Raheem Mostert at the start of this 12th round here. What do you think, Sean?
Well, I know that there have not been a lot of positive developments for the guy that a lot of us thought was the probably the fourth best wide receiver prospect in this draft. But with being fairly set at some of these positions, he would be kind of interesting here as a look toward a little bit later in the season, setting up some of those kinds of possibilities. There is a running back here who I think is really talented and has managed to like do everything weird possible to like knock down his value. He would be somebody that I think, you know, again, kind of pointing toward the second half of the season, even though a lot of people were hoping that he could do something early. I mean, those are kind of the two guys I'm probably most fired up about. We kind of the most fun picks.
Let's push also the back.
There's, I mean, the tight end you floated last time is here, right?
Dolchich?
Yeah, he is, but
yeah, he's here.
I like the receiver.
The receiver. I'm good with the receiver because receiver is going to dry up after this pick. Yeah, like, this is probably our last.
We're talking about Marvin Mims, right?
Yeah, I'm good with Marvin Mims. I just want to say, you know, we were supposed to take Dolchich over too, and he's
no.
Here, so
I mean, I'm Mims here. We doing it?
You don't acknowledge that it was flat otherwise.
All right.
This is why I'm hot. I'm hot because I'm fly, you ain't because you mad.
This is why we act. Why? The girls have loved me, so we know that we act. Acting up the cha-cha. This is why we act. Step up in the club of champagne. We have pop. Serious, we serious and a chat. We are chat. The girls have loved me, cause we touch certain spot. This is why we hot remix?
I've never heard that one.
What I like about that clip, my favorite part, is when Mims is like running over the middle of the field and he gets like tackled by like this shoestring ankle tackle bullshit that he should not get tackled by. But then he gets up and does this like really sweet celebration and I'm like, I'm back in.
As Andrew says, rest in peace to all of your Mims shares. That's the Mims mush. Yeah. The Mims mush is
the Mims mush.
We've done
Mims,
it.
We got a Mims clip.
From the crew who has mushed LaVisca.
I had not seen that clip before. I love That's it. Right. We sent that in.
Yeah. We mushed Sky Moore, and now we will mush Marvin Mims.
Pete, did you make that or did someone else make that?
No, I believe Chris. Was that you? I'm pretty sure it was Chris. Chris, please, I apologize. There's been a lot of people I've worked with on clips.
Sean, were you talking about Kendre Miller as the running back?
I was, but I'm still like processing that clip. And I really like Texas Tech's back end defense there.
It was Phil. My bad, Phil. I worked with Chris on another clip. Look at that. That clip just got Sue Ann to become a YouTube member. That's how you know we're doing good things around here. Awesome job, Phil.
Sean, I thought we could push Kendre. I've seen him go as late as 13-10. And took him at 13-10 just earlier this week. So a little bit surprised to see him go there, honestly, because I've seen him go to the 13th round multiple times. But yeah, he did go right after us.
Mm.
We're getting a little thin at running back, but the chat pointed out a little bit ago, we do have 3 2,000-yard rushers on our team, so we don't actually need to worry too much.
Yeah. It is
funny. I like
funny.
That Mims pick. That was fun.
It was. And we set out to do a robust running back draft, and now we're all like, oh, man, these running backs are flying off the board, feeling a little naked here at running back.
Well, it reminds me a little bit of the NFC draft that we did with Leone. That was only two guys. Like, I don't know. The upside that we have at running back is pretty ridiculous. I mean, we've got McCaffrey going for 2,000 total yards. Dobbins is going for 2,000 yards. On the ground. How many yards do we have from ETN?
His coach says 1,700, so just boost that by a couple. I mean, he's going to catch some passes too, right? So
that's right. So there's another 2,000 total yards. So we got...
Why did we draft Dobbins ahead of ETN if Dobbins is going for 2,000 and ETN's going for 1,700?
Touchdowns, dude.
uh. I'd also like to say that since we have three running backs, we could be done at the position.
I think I think we could too, yeah.
That sounds really fun. I'm in. Yeah. I'm always in to get weird.
So after we take Mims, Jeff Wilson goes, Kendre Miller goes, Devin Singletary, Chig, Alan Lazard. The Watson drafter adds Kirk Cousins to complete his stack with Justin Jefferson. And we are staring down our 13th round pick here.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of options at one position, especially if we don't care to take any more running backs. I'm not like doing a great job of hiding the position I'm talking about.
Yeah, running back.
What do you think about Jerome Ford?
Jerome Ford's interesting.
Yeah, I mean, he's hurt right now, but
he's hurt, and I don't. It sounds like he's iffy for week one, which I guess he's kind of Fournette's out there, right? So that would be the concern.
One of the things that you had written about, Ben, and I hadn't necessarily seen, but I have seen in some other, have at least seen referenced in some other places as I tried to confirm that sense, is this idea that, I mean, Ford is really locked in to that two spot, at least according to the people reporting on the Browns. Yeah. And I just
talked about it on the broadcast. You're referencing my preseason stealing signals, and right. I heard it on the broadcast. They were talking about it like it was very, very clear. They held him out. This is before he got hurt in practice, but they held him out because he's very locked in. And the battle is for the number three job. I mean, that was.
They absolutely love him. And I mean, there's standalone value plus there's contingent value. And hopefully we would never need to use this standalone value with the guys that we have. But he is an interesting pick, I think, at this price.
Ty Chandler goes. Is Jerome Ford the pick here, guys?
You're tight.
I would take Dulcich at this point.
That was the other. I was going to be like, at this price, Sean, are you uber spooked on Dulcich where he's not a value here?
Well, my exposures are high enough that I am now not adding. But at this price, it's a little bit ridiculous. Not ridiculous, but just I don't even think he has to be a guy who runs a ton of routes. If they are willing to play him at this price, it helps you.
Right.
It helps us if we have a rookie tight end as our top guy. Like, I don't know. I think he can kind of be a kind of a bust and still help us.
Also, the guy who is in theory playing ahead of him is not good. And at some point you would expect the team to move in a different direction.
Yeah, I think
I'm definitely down. I was down for Dulcich earlier. So you guys want to do it?
Yeah,
yeah.
All right, let's do it.
You wanted to push Tua. We wanted to push Dulcich.
Hey, we got a flip, right?
Both of us were right.
Oh, roll it.
Wait. Oh shit, you're right. God, I'm slacking.
God, it's so beautiful. I love all his laugh. He's like feeling awkward.
He feels really awkward. He's like, why is this guy talking about my hair? Just trying to meet my fucking coach.
Well, if we want to take JJ Taylor, we can complete the triumvirate of
tonight. By the way, like Dulcich looked like a hit, we got our clip, everything's looking good, and then sure enough, he benched for Adam Troutman. Yeah, we mushed him. It was a sneaky mush that time. Sneaky mush.
Dude, all right. The David Bell one was the worst because that's an incredible clip, and we only got to play it like five times, and he's just gone.
I know, man. Have you guys ever thought about like streaming some baseball?
David Bell's a cautionary tale of these players we fall in love with, and you're like, man, he could just be the Jarvis Landry on the Browns. Let's make a clip for him. Next thing you know, he's out of our lives.
He's 2023 forever. Jarvis Landry.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, man. Jerome Ford does go off the board to team 9 here. Some interesting constructions. Team 10 takes their fourth wide receiver in the 13th round with KJ Osborne. Don't laugh, Gretch.
I called it in. I tried. The way he said it was so good.
Funny.
With KJ Osborne, just deadpan.
Don't laugh, Gretch.
I have, you know what? You know, sometimes I don't like want to talk about picks that we might make. I've never seen like the fantasy community on Puka. Like this Puka shit is out of control. Everyone loves
especially
Puka.
We have yet, I believe, to mention this dude's name on the show. They want a clip for him.
Dude, the Puka slappies are just out of control right
if
now.
If you are going to make a clip, I want to get some Puka shells in the clip. Are you gonna, remember the Puka shell fan?
Yeah.
I will give it to you. Like the Saints signed Jimmy Graham as a bit. Every best ball chat has Puka as a bit. Like everyone needs their bit. I like
Puka
as a bit.
It was the Puka shell and the gelled. Remember like the gelled down, like combed out hair? Yeah. The 90s, man. What were we doing? Luckily, I never did either of those things. My hair was too frizzy.
Why would anyone take Puka when Tutu Atwell is still on the board? Right, Sean?
I think he's pretty good.
You're breaking your own rules here, bud.
I mean, I still have people telling me that Van Jefferson is going to have a peak Robert Woods year too, which I think also creates.
Is that a compliment? A peak Robert Woods year?
It is. For Van Jefferson, it is. Now, who are those people? Are they people you respect and trust or people that you're making fun of? You're so deadpan here. I'm actually not sure what you're saying.
It just, one of the things I do think is a little bit interesting and, you know, would have been potentially a discussion if we had gotten Cup instead and then hadn't gotten, you know, fantastic value on Tua. Just like if you get into big trouble, would you feel comfortable with Matthew Stafford going back to 2021 if like these guys who are buzzy late add a little bit, right? I mean, I don't think that there's any way they could come through on what the buzz is, but if they would add something, does that make Stafford with Cup more interesting than, you know, it looked last year where everything was, you know, pretty traumatic?
I think so. I take him at best ball. I think he has some upside. I think his weekly upside, like in a couple different ways, like either the weapons come on or he, you know, is just on the team is bad enough to where they have to chuck it and his elbow is a bit healthier. And then his job security. So I take him. I mean, I guess he could just like re-injure the elbow and he's old. So he's not like the safest guy in the world, but I've been betting on him a decent amount in best ball.
We got our first defense off the board, Philadelphia defense. We also see Tank Dell, Rondale Moore, Geno Smith. We're about to pick in the 14th round here. We got one quarterback. We got three running backs, two tight ends, one quarterback, and 7 wide receivers. Chase Brown comes off the board. What are you guys thinking here?
I put a couple names in the chat. I don't know about the
chat.
Pushing one or...
Well, I think the guy that you've mentioned, Ben, probably gets through a round or two.
Okay, that's what I was wondering.
Yeah.
So what about the first name I said? Is that a guy that's interesting to anyone? It doesn't.
Yeah.
It's not really that interesting to me. It just kind of a value at this point.
He's mildly interesting to me. I mean,
So we could talk about Deontay Foreman because he's not coming back. He's the top of the running back queue.
Chat's pounding the table for another clip. I don't
they want Justin Tucker.
Yeah, they want Tucker.
Yeah, let's relax on Justin Tucker.
Yeah. Just trying to see. I mean, Foreman does almost seem like the last viable running back, so I kind of like him as our RB.
Do you have any real reason to not take him, Sean, as our running back that is like
No, I
17 spots lower that you just absolutely love and would smash over Deontay Foreman?
No, I was going to mention Chase Brown. There are guys who go undrafted that I think are interesting, but Foreman is the last guy who's getting drafted, who I think is draftable, if that makes sense. I mean, he's the last guy I think who's...
No, I knew there was guys that are not getting drafted that you were probably willing to take over Deontay Foreman.
Well, there are players who I think are not going, who will end up being interesting waiver wire ads. I mean, obviously that always happens. I think you could put him there in round 20. But of the guys who are being drafted right now, I think that Foreman is the last person who is just even rosterable right now.
Yeah.
Got it. I mean, looking at the names after, so we take Foreman here in the 14th round, just at the top of the queue by ADP, you're looking at Kareem Hunt, Gus Edwards, Leonard Fournette, CEH, Joshua Kelly, Deuce Vaughn, Kyren Williams, Denarik Prince, Chase Edmonds. I mean, it's the bottom of the barrel.
Cordero Patterson's down there somewhere. Keep going.
Didn't he get hurt? Isn't he banged up now?
It does have a Q next to him. Yeah.
It's the Cordero Patterson dream is probably going to die pretty quick. I don't know why it was ever a dream.
You were so in. You convinced me.
They got Mac Hollins as their wide receiver, too. Like, the whole thing was he's going to play wide receiver, and now he's, like, banged up, and it's like, oh, yeah, he's fucking old.
You knew that before.
I knew it before. It's just as soon as he got banged up, I realized it more clearly.
That's fair.
Here you go, Sean. Ryan's giving you the idea for your next article. These undrafted players are the best pick in the 13th round. Ooh, it's an article by Sean I would read the hell out of.
That's a really good article. That's a perfect title.
It's a perfect
title. I almost want you to go write that now.
You so literally have to have that up on RotoViz in the next couple of days. Like, I don't know how you don't.
That's pretty clicky. I'll deliver on that.
Yes.
The only thing you need to change, Sean, is some of the YouTubers now will do this thing where they'll say, like, the five players your idiot league mates aren't drafting that you draft. That's the only other part you need to add to that. But you would never call your league mates idiots, so that's probably not part of your brand.
That doesn't feel like a Sean title to me.
Yeah.
You can just, like, insinuate it a little bit with, like, the people who are still watching Netflix or...
You know. Sean, what shows are you watching? Are
still watching Netflix?
Hey man, Drive to Survive. It's good, okay?
I still watch Netflix. What's wrong with still watching?
I'll give it to Sean.
It's definitely gotten worse.
There's nothing on there.
I don't really,
like,
go on there anymore.
Everything's on Apple TV, HBO, Hulu. Now Netflix is.
I've actually considered canceling it, but Drive to Survive gets me.
Yeah. Sean, what's the show right
now? How do you say that? I have not watched a show on Netflix in a really long time, because all the recent shows have been on all those other places, Pete.
Well, they also cancel there. Like, there's a couple shows. The people who did Dark did another show. It was, like, even more intense, and that seems like something you'd be into, Sean. Did you watch that show?
What was the more intense one?
1898, I think it was called.
Yeah, I started watching it and I was just like, this is too much.
It was, like, real intense, but then they canceled it after one season. And it's like a dark level. It's gonna be three seasons, and they were gonna do the whole thing where it gets crazier and crazier and crazier.
Is that the one on the boat?
Yeah, but then there, if you think space is not involved, you're wrong. They canceled that, yeah.
I did watch that season. Yeah. Oh, man.
It really pissed me off. I'm like, you can't. Don't.
Yeah.
I need to know what the fuck was going on. And now.
But also, the space thing at the end of the season was pretty cheap. It was like, yeah, this is, I mean.
Well, also, there's no way that was. They weren't in there. There was going to be another thing above space.
Right. Yeah. There was layers. Yeah.
But I wanted to know what the hell was happening. And now I'm mad that I never will.
It was kind of, I thought it was a little bit of a rug pull. It was like, it was intriguing throughout the series, and then it just got, like, a little crazier and crazier and crazier, and then they're like, oh, it was all a dream. You know, like, that was the plot line.
It's a simulation sort of thing going on there, right?
Yeah.
The listeners have got to love us just, like, deep diving into a canceled Netflix show.
Spoiler alert, you're never going to see what happens.
Yeah. I don't think we have to do spoiler alerts because...
Right. It's dead.
Yeah. It's dead.
All right, we're about to.
Oh, Mindhunter got canceled. That was a great show.
Mindhunter was good. Justin Ross comes off the board. We don't get to roll that clip. About to pick in the 15th round here.
We have a Justin Ross clip?
We do. We do. We got clips for half the NFL now. Isaiah Likely comes off the board. You got some Ave Maria, Jared Goff, a couple guys in the queue. What do you guys think?
Can we talk about the guys in the queue yet, or are we trying to push them?
I think we take the dude that I mentioned in the chat before too long, because I know both Pat and Sean love him, and I think we got to get him on this team. I don't even like him that much.
I would love to take him.
Yeah, let's do
Sean,
it.
Sean? Michael Mayer?
Yeah, I mean, his ADP is still another round and a half, but I don't think you can count on that at this range. And he is a really good fit with this particular team. One of the things we had discussed a little bit beforehand was this idea of if we don't get Tua and you can get your quarterback pulled from you in these formats, especially if you pull it like we wanted to do, then we could load up on a variety of late QBs. I don't know if that is as necessary now, even though obviously Tua has some pretty, I actually think the injury risk is more or less pretty similar to every other quarterback, but you could say that maybe there's more extreme injury risk. Even with that, I don't know that we necessarily need to go that route. And with that being the case, I mean, the two guys here that I liked, I wouldn't have anybody in between. So I don't think there's any like need to push them down. And Mayer gives you that other option where I think there are some good ways to look for tight ends who might have the right type of role to, you know, get you across. And we see some of those guys going from 12 to 14. I think that Mayer is another player who just is simply so good, even though he doesn't have the athleticism of a Laporta. And again, you kind of look at what the team is trying to do. And the Raiders, you know, want to build this very new identity around Jimmy Garoppolo and the new weapons that they brought in. You know, that may or may not work. And yet, I mean, Mayer has a chance to be a breakout. Now, I'm always wanting to kind of stack breakout options at tight end with the idea that maybe we do hit, even if the odds aren't great for us. Because when we're talking about not just winning our league, which I think our team is set up nicely to do, even if you don't get great tight end production, when then you start going and facing the truly awesome teams in the big race, I mean, you're going to be looking for not just somebody who gets you through, but that at least chance at the big points. And I think that Dolchich gives us that too, because, you know, the other guys there, you know, probably if Greg Dulcich is who we think he is, those other people are going to fade away. And so we've got three shots at it now. And, you know, you're starting to give yourself a real chance, even if the shot for each one of them is a little bit thin, you know, it's starting to build up to where I really like where we are.
Yeah, I'm really excited to add Hunter Henry to this. Sean and I have been going back and forth on this. He really likes just taking a bunch of those shot plays that he was describing. I really like to get one of the boring guys like Hunter Henry into the mix. He just goes. You're saved from Hunter Henry.
I think Hunter Henry's a fine pick. He's just, you know, not quite as high upside as Mayer.
For sure.
Yeah.
Is the 10 hole not taking tight ends? Are they on a tight end fast?
The 10 hole has not taken a tight end. They've barely taken wide receivers.
Three quarterbacks.
Yep. This is barely not taking receivers. We can confirm that.
They took Damian Harris before their wide receiver 4. He was their running back 7. I mean, they know how to pick running backs, but besides that. Damn it, he's the Najee Harris and Alexander Mattison draft trade. He took Damian Harris. This is not good for the Damian Harris brand.
Can I see the team name again real quick?
The team name is...
Oh, he took Mixon too.
TaylorMade.
So this guy's name is Taylor, and he names his team TaylorMade.
Mixon, Harris, Madison, Dalvin Cook, Jamal Williams. Either that or what? And he took Damian Harris. I mean, I don't think I've taken those 5 running backs. I don't think I've taken them five times in all the drafts I've done combined. David Harris. Damn, that guy knows ball.
JJ Taylor made. There it is.
There we go.
There it is.
It's JJ Taylor. Roll the clip. Should we roll the clip for this guy?
If someone takes JJ Taylor, I will roll the clip. Don't tempt me with.
There we go.
Time.
He took Conklin.
Yeah, Conklin goes here. All right.
Well, Sean's got another upside tight end he mentioned to us. Earlier in our chats, he referenced another upside tight end that could be a tight end four here.
Do we want to go?
Can you remind me of who it was?
Yeah.
Do go we want to go completely? Do we want to just go one QB or do we want to? I mean, one of the things that I
like the idea you if the Q is what you're floating, I like.
Yes, it. I like the setup. I like what the Q is.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Sean.
Well, it may seem really strange, but I'm very comfortable with either one QB if you're going to start that QB and then you're going to, you know, add in if you run into an injury, or as many as four I talked about earlier. But there is a player here who, again, we're talking about how do you win the tournament that I think becomes kind of interesting.
Can you put him in the chat, somebody?
Ben, yeah. you have this player italicized in your rankings. Are you
I don't know who it is.
I put it in the chat.
It's in the chat.
Oh, that's fine.
Taylor yeah, made a fool out of you. He did a little bit. He took Conklin right after we made fun of him for not taking tight ends.
Jalin Hyatt goes off the board, who is also a guy we had put in the queue here. Dawson Knox comes off the board, and then Richie James.
Yeah, I like – can we – speak freely?
Yes.
Yeah, go for it.
Permission.
I think taking
freely,
Kyler
sir.
Makes a ton of sense. A ton of sense for this team.
He feels like a great backstop with Tua. If you're going to play for that upside, and we're probably going to only do two QBs here. Gresh?
Yes.
You have someone else you like more?
Yeah, I said go for it a couple times. Yep. I do have him italicized as a fade in my rankings. I mean, mostly thinking for my subscribers that are playing in a lot of like home leagues and things like that. I do think there's like a potential fool's gold element to it that my immediate response this offseason was, oh, I mean, the only cheap upside candidate here. He used to be a top five quarterback. Like, this is amazing. But I do think there's concern that he won't run as much when he comes back and all those things. But Sean's got me a little more excited. He's talking about some camp buzz. I'll probably unitalicize him, move him up a little bit at some point.
Unitalicize him.
We'll turn him off the fade. But yeah, when you're talking about a deeper format like this particularly, yeah, I mean, it's a different ball game. The ranks are tough. It's tough to make it perfect. But yeah, I mean, I totally understand the merit of taking him here.
Yeah. So we do add Kyler as our second QB. Go ahead.
The chat is killing us here because they're saying from a vibes-based perspective, Kyler was not a good addition to this team.
Wait, we're worried about vibes?
Yeah, what's wrong with Kyler's vibes?
What's wrong with Kyler's
Kyler
vibes?
Chills and plays COD. What's he doing to anyone?
Playing video games, dude. Just chill.
Person chill here says, person says Kyler's going to quit football and stream.
Well,
man, just let him live his life, bro.
I don't want to live his life if he's planning on streaming Call of Duty, because that's the problem for this team.
When Tua quits football, we're going to be streaming quarterback. So, you know, Kyler will come in handy then.
Yeah.
Schefter, Kyler might not even play. Schefter just reported about this. Can you link that Schefter report where Kyler's going to quit playing?
Well, I'm going to go to the old Twitter.com.
Oops. Where did my drop board go here? Sean, how much kicker and defense research have you done?
I always put that last, but I usually forget to do it until I've done most of my main events, and then it's too late.
Yeah, it sounds familiar around here. I'm scrolling through Schefter's Twitter account, retweeted Seattle Seahawks account, retweeted New York Jets, talking about raising money for Hawaii shirts. Chargers meme, Joe Mixon being found guilty. I'm struggling.
The last
time
he tweeted about Kyler was on July 30th. And let me just check Murray. The last time he tweeted the word Murray was also July 30th. So wow. Bullshit on this comment.
Yeah, man. And to think that I take all of the chat's words as gospel. This has really shattered my faith in the chat knowing what they're talking about.
Get yourself in order, chat. I mean, what I like about the chat is there's usually some self-policing in the chat. And
Yeah. Fix your priors. All right. We are about to be on the clock here in the 17th.
I got a table to pound in the 17th round. You ready for this?
Pound it away.
I'm ready.
I hope it's what you guys want to do, too.
I do, too.
That's such a polite table pounding. I hope you also like what I want.
I mean, we got to stack up. We got to stack this bitch up.
We definitely got to stack this bitch up.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Let's stack this bitch up.
With Greg Dortch, right? We're all on the same page.
Yeah. With Greg Dortch is what you're saying, right?
Exactly.
Yes. May I pound, gentlemen? Yes, we can pound. Any objections to one Mr. Trey McBride here?
No objections, Your Honor.
Sean, any objections, Your Honor?
He also factors in fairly high on my exposure leaderboard, which is not good, but I'm in favor of it right here.
Sean, don't use our main event draft to balance your exposures.
It's not good.
It's not good. We're going to take a peek on him. We didn't get the four QBs, Sean, but we did get the four tight ends, and they're all fun.
Have we done a true crank purple with Sean before?
I don't think so.
I don't know.
Yeah.
It's almost like a stream swap with Crack Rock here. We got to go zero running back with Crack Rock.
It's a very Sean tight end room, which I'm always trying to make him draft like Dawson Knox and Hunter Henry and stuff when we draft together. So I'm glad he got to play the hits here.
This is a fun one.
It's the fun when you try and find some information on Trey McBride, and it's all about like how he's and somehow this doesn't factor in Zach Ertz, who I guess is not around. I don't know, but like he's now the leader in the tight end room. Like you've got a guy who's the leader in your like offensive room who's got like three NFL receptions. So,
but you like him.
Trey McBride was a very good college player. He is incredibly athletic. And so if you're going to bet on that kind of second year leap at the tight end position, you want to do it for a player who, you know, has some of that past production, is extremely athletic, was a priority for the team before everything changed, and isn't a team where, I mean, there's some buzz for Michael Wilson, but the Cardinals need a guy who could go out there and add some dynamism to their roster, who's not like a pure lottery ticket kind of player. And I'm not even necessarily saying that Trey McBride is that guy. I mean, certainly in fantasy, he's looked at as a lottery ticket. But I think there's some under-the-radar enthusiasm about him. And again, I mean, you look back to the one big game he did have, and we're talking about a tight end where the expectations are slightly different. He was incredible in that game. And when it comes, you know, down the stretch, I think that does give you a little bit of enthusiasm carrying over, because obviously there are a lot of things that were dysfunctional about the Cardinals last season to where we can, you know, if you want to make a case for someone who is in the 17th round that isn't going to cost you in redraft, now in my best ball leagues it may, but you know, this is the good kind of bet to make.
Sean, are you sad to see Kenny Pickett and Sam Howell come off the board and not be on our team?
I know it is too bad, because Pat was saying, I mean, every time that you know, we have our little chats and Pat's like, I'm getting this little vibe that, you know, like he might do it. He might be that fun. That's not the whole thing. Usually it's like he's going to get himself benched because he's fun. But I mean, Sam Howell is fun. So
Sam Howell is fun. Like I actually am kind of disappointed we haven't taken him yet in a main event, because that is the format I think you take Sam Howell in. Like I've been very skittish of taking Sam Howell in best ball, but like it, that is a fear-based take. Like, I think he's going to be fun. I worry how much that fun lasts, you know, how long we have of it. But if you want to punt court, like if we didn't take Tua and we took like Kyler and then Howell and then probably a third quarterback after that, I mean, I could see that working, you know. I think he's going to be chucking them. I think he's going to be chucking the ball downfield, and he's got good weapons and he runs a little bit, so it could work.
Should we add the other biggest like injury uncertainty guy to the Tua Kyler mix and stack up our first round pick?
No.
Oh.
Is that what you're saying? I'm not sure what you're saying.
I'm saying Brock Purdy, which I don't even mind to say because I don't actually like it that much. But
oh, I thought you were saying Lance for a second. I was like, oh,
no. I just roll up and remember who was our first round
pick. Tua with the concussions, Kyler with the knee, Purdy with the elbow are all guys that I think have been held down all offseason by the, like, fear of injuries, and it would just be a really funny three quarterbacks to have. We don't know who's going to be healthy, but we're just going to throw them all out there.
No, I guess I'd be open to that.
We got one more pick, right? Before kickers and defense here. Running back, absolutely wiped. I guess a couple tight end names if you squint. Wide receiver, a couple names we got in the queue who could be fun.
We could just go kicker and D and like lock up decent options, but.
I was going to say, where is everybody on that in terms of, you know, do we want to get a kicker in a high scoring offense, or that isn't a big priority?
No, let's do it.
I think we could punt our last pick until the 19th or 20th, or sorry, our last non kicker defense pick.
I floated a guy in the private chat, which,
yeah,
you know, I think would be fun.
Also, shout out to Stephanie, who's going to be helping us with our waivers this year, who loves the idea of us getting a decent kicker in defense.
I got you, Stephanie.
Yeah, Stephanie, we'll toss you a bone. I told her she didn't read the fine print, which is us lazily selecting our kicker in defense in the 19th and 20th round of every single draft.
I mean, we got McPherson sitting there, right?
Let me make a case for Michael Wilson as a starter on the team where we just drafted Kyler and double stacks that bitch up for us.
You're gonna make the case, or are you gonna say you're gonna make the case?
He's athletic and stacked. He's athletic, stacked, and starting. That's the whole case.
Can he kick as far as Evan McPherson?
He cannot. But he plays a better position.
Sean, Evan McPherson, or Michael Wilson?
Or a different kicker.
Pat, what are the chances that Wilson comes back around? I do have some guys I like better at the positions left, but I also think they may not even get picked up in free agency in week one, in which case, you know, you're not using that roster spot very effectively for the first weekend.
So do you like McPherson?
Yeah, I mean, they're going to score a ton, and he's got a massive leg. And so, I mean, it probably doesn't matter. Massive leg. But...
Well, when T. Higgins falls down on the one, we are going to love all of these vehicles.
I do like, so here's where the two cases, just for the record, because, you know, I think this is helpful for the debaters out there. Okay. I went with, I went with athletic, stacked, and starting. And Sean went with, they're going to score a ton of points and has a massive leg. And that argument won the day. So, you know, just take notes, do with that information what you will.
Yeah. I mean, he kicks hard, bro.
He kicks hard.
I mean, Pat, do you even know kickers, bro? Do you know ball?
I don't know. I truly don't know kicking. I don't know.
I think we got a steal there. I think that was some bye week slappies. These guys are afraid of his week 7 bye. And I mean, that Evan McPherson folded a kicker 5. I mean,
what? Oh, you just reminded me I'm supposed to look at bye weeks. We're pretty evenly distributed on our bye weeks, I will say. LaPorta and Dolchich both in week 9. Good thing we got Michael Mayer and Trey McBride. We cranked it purple to cover it.
They're talking about the Chasing Kickers Club. That was the most kickers analysis you're getting out of me this whole year.
No, you're right. You're right. We did chase kickers.
Kicker Chasing. It's the show where we chase the best kickers. The kickers that help you win championships. The biggest legs. The breaking news. It's everything you've come to love and know. The time is now for Kicker Chasing. Let's get some fucking kickers.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Evan McPherson.
I love the way the kicker is just plastered on like a child today. Did a kicker do this?
Hey, I made that. I mean, this is back before I outsourced clips to the audience and then sent them through a rigorous editing process.
But I mean, it's part of the bit that it's like, oh, we're just slapping kicker over this and chasing some fucking kickers.
It is amazing. Pete, you're like, I mean, it is amazing, right? Like, apparently in everything, you first create and then you go into the director phase. Just give notes, but I don't even know if you're saving any time. It's just more fulfilling.
No, I'm incapable. I outsource all of my editing work now. I got lots of people helping out, and I don't even know how to edit videos anymore. That's probably the last video I ever edited was that JC video.
Amazing.
Yeah, you got to give Kevin's David Bell clip that needed no intervention by me on it. Kevin nailed it right out of the gate. God,
yeah,
Vincent, what is the I wish I had 8 hours to make a clip. God, that would be the life.
Ryan asking, was that Pat and Ben on the Oh Yeah? That's not us, but who is it?
It's a good question. I think I must have been searching for Oh Yeah sound bites on my royalty free music site that I use.
Nice.
Oh, that's so good.
Sean, you're over there.
It'd be great if you got sued for the Oh Yeah, if it wasn't extra royalty free.
You're over there thinking hard about something. Is it a defense? Is it a sleeper play? What do we got?
Well, I'm trying to balance some of my own personal incentives here because I kind of want to push a defense so that I don't have to just come out and say that I don't want Michael Wilson. But then I'm like, but if Michael Wilson has a huge game in week one, then that would be worse than any other scenario. So we better just take Michael Wilson.
It is a rule on this show. If someone floats a player the round before and he comes back around, we are legally obligated to take
Well,
him.
Not if Sean's fully out on Michael Wilson.
I don't want to just come out and say that I don't want Michael Wilson on this team.
The athletics action starting, Sean. What don't you get about that?
What's the anti Michael Wilson case, Sean? And I know a body bag.
I mean, he had a long time in college to prove that he could stay healthy or that he was good when he was healthy or any of those kinds of things. But I do want to take him here because that's argument. Convince me.
That's a lie.
Because if we. Well, there's a guy that
spit it out. He's like the guy that argument.
You can't even say it. That is argument.
I'm convinced. I'm more convinced.
You're the least convinced person I've ever seen.
That was like a blink twice if this is a hostage video thing.
There is a player I really want for this team, but he's going to be in that vertical.
Is he a defense, Sean? Because that would work out well.
No, he's one of these players who the best pick in round 13, even though he's going undrafted.
But if he's going to rise before we can add him, then we should have drafted him.
Well, Pete
does
and I
his
have
name
Ryan 45
with Rondale? Yeah.
We have about 45% in underdog, so hopefully he plays before too late in the season.
Yeah, exactly. Oh man.
Oh, I thought his name might rhyme with fucker. I mean sucker.
I think that's another one. There's a We gotta get these.
Oh, Josh Palmer. We gotta get not Josh Palmer, Trey Palmer. We gotta get some Trey Palmer shares at some point.
Mm.
Not really.
Nice to have a guy you feel comfortable cutting, you know, just right away where you don't have any emotional attachment to it. That's the Trey Palmer thesis.
I'm not making a clip, but
Gretch, make a clip. I'll take it easy on you on the rigorous editing process.
It'll mush him, but he's gonna be too good for a clip, unfortunately.
All right, our team as we head into the last round: Christian McCaffrey, Jalen Waddle, T. Higgins. Man, that Christian McCaffrey pick feels legitimately ages ago. CMC, Jalen Waddle, T. Higgins, Travis Etienne, JSN, J.K. Dobbins, George Pickens, Quentin Johnston, Treylon Burks. Shout out to the audio listeners: Sam Laporta, Tua, controversial Tua selection could have pushed into the 12th. Marvin Mims, Greg Dulcich by the dip, Donta Foreman, the last draftable player, Michael Mayer, Kyler Murray, why not? Trey McBride, stack it up. Evan McPherson, huge leg. Michael Wilson, stack that bitch up twice, and then we're heading into the 20th round.
So the chat, very torn on the Michael Wilson pick. We've got Michael Wilson watches Netflix. Then we've got Michael Wilson equals Anquan Boldin tears up week one. Michael Wilson has a good locker room personality. And what was it? There's one more. Oh, Harb said, I prefer Trey Palmer in managed, parentheses, so I can cut it.
What I'm getting is Michael Wilson's a polarizing player, Pat.
He really is.
The Michael Wilson watches Netflix got Sean to do a legitimate spit take there.
Love it.
Sean, I didn't get to hear. What show are you watching right now?
I was trying to think because Colin and I actually even did a like best show on like every streaming service bit on one of our shows. I was watching a little bit of Pat referenced it on one of our current or recent land the plane situations where you have that hijack. They're almost there.
Hijack's
taking
awesome.
Off again.
They're going to stretch that. That's going to on for five seasons and a week will have passed.
No,
that's where we're headed with that.
They landed the plane well in season one.
We're on the clock.
Let's just keep talking about the plane. I don't what plane are we talking about?
The one that Idris Elba saved from being hijacked.
I mean, the first defense you name, I will say yes to. So, but.
Yeah. Wait, who's the week one schedule? Chat.
Steelers.
Chat.
Are we Steelers versus Brock Purdy? Are we okay with that, or do we want to go Denver versus Sam Howell?
Wait, Steelers are available. Steelers.
Yeah, Steelers are available.
Who do they play in week two?
You tell me. Cleveland week two. Is it still the Iron Curtain?
Then the Raiders. Yeah, I mean, Purdy, yeah, we're kind of probably not a great match for against the Niners, but let's do it.
I mean, Brock Purdy, elbow's still going to be hurting him. Throws a few.
And then
picks.
You got Deshaun Watson, and then you got the Raiders, and then you got the Texans. Pretty good start.
CMC catches 14 balls. Brock Purdy throws four picks. I think it works out.
That's another one, too, where it. It is nice for Stephanie to have that defense in there.
Yeah.
Sean's already thinking about Stephanie.
We've got Stephanie, her four weeks there.
There we go.
That's having 4 weeks of a defense is pretty nice for the waivers.
Yeah, I've never had a defense for more than 1 week. You're welcome, Stephanie. The team is in the books, Sean. Give us your thoughts. Let people know you had come into this draft with aspirations to draft 19 running backs and 14 quarterbacks. We didn't quite do that, but we drafted a team.
Man, and this is perfect, right? This is one of the most fun teams you could draft. I don't know that talk about structure is as important in redraft, but to have balanced out our positional objectives so well, we came in not – like locked in. We certainly could have gone with a Justin Fields and that would have been a fine pick, but to get Dobbins where we got him, you had a Javonte Williams option there as well, I think. But to get those three running backs with the crazy upside and to have Higgins fall to us, but then to be able to come back and to get Pickens, to get Johnston, to get Treylon Burks when you're not going to need to start him during this time period that he's recovering from that injury, that it's really unfortunate for him. It's really unfortunate for the Titans and for, you know, people with shares in best ball, but it's almost perfect for you if you're trying to build out this kind of team in redraft, because you got a guy who you don't have to start right away, who has, again, just league winning upside. You're talking about round nine. That should not be the case. And then to be able to put Tua and Kyler together, really the two quarterbacks outside of the elite quarterbacks who you can look at, and you project yourself forward, you use those flash forward moments, and you say, who could be a tournament winner who doesn't go with those elite guys? These are the two players, and they're both on our roster. Now, there are other players I like in there who, yeah, they've got that really low probability, but Tua and Kyler are the two very clear-cut guys. They have both of them there, and then to take those four tight ends, where if you get an elite tight end, you're probably not going that route. But one of the things we kind of ran into and we saw is that there are not a lot of great picks in the double-digit rounds, which, you know, there shouldn't be. And if you can hit contingent plays at tight end where, I mean, two of those guys are elite athletes. Dulcich has a lot of receiving ability in his profile. And then Mayer is this fantastic overall tight end. To have some differences in the profile, but to have that upside in the profile, I mean, it feels a long time since we were in those single-digit rounds that were so exciting. But, I mean, you know, if you were to fall asleep and draft the perfect team and then wake up and be like, oh, it didn't happen, this is the team. So, again, it doesn't mean you're going to win, because so many things can happen, you know, even before we start. But I love what we were able to do. And we talked – we had a little celebration as soon as we got the 106, because it does set you up so perfectly. So I think that we have to be appreciative of just having gotten the best draft slot too. That allows you to do things that people at the edges probably can't do. But again, I mean, this was so much fun to draft this team. And I love the way that it looks at the end.
Every time you've ever broke down a team that we've drafted together, I'm convinced it's going to win.
I want to run through a fucking brick wall and count my million. Person says he is a time traveler. This team does win. Nice. It's official.
Love it.
I do think that's like a good point about like the drafting from the middle. It does, you know, we had our some decision points, but man, it feels so much better than when you're having to make those decisions on either of the wraps, where you're essentially like planting your flag, reaching to get the guy, like letting the draft come to you from the middle of the board feels really good.
Yeah, we got a couple really nice values fall our way. We did a couple reachy things, you know, we took JSN, the chat revolted, right? But we got most of the guys we took, it felt like pretty easy clicks, pretty great values. And that is the dream when you're in the middle of the board. That's what it opens up to you. So you kind of need the rest of the room to cooperate and hand you the guys that you like more. But for the most part, that happened here. So I think it's a really fun team. It's like, I love a team that feels like it's working together. You know, this team's like, you get the running back, you know, investment is higher than we typically make, but it's with guys that have a ton of upside, but also like should have, two of the guys should have very big roles right out of the gate. I think Dobbins will as well. And what do we pair that with? We pair that with scratch offs at tight end, with a lot of rookie second year, even injury risk at wide receiver, but all super high upside guys. And then we have high upside at quarterback for cheap price tag. So it's just like, that's like exactly, I feel like, how you should build out
that's a great team
that spent a little bit more at running back.
It's one of the, like, this is one of those teams where, like, sometimes you get in season and you're like, man, what do we do with our bench here? There's so many things that we need to accomplish with these last few roster spots. I want to add some depth at this position, this position, this position. And we only took four running backs, and we might not even keep Deontay Foreman that long. If the other three just hit, we'll just roll with three probably. Like, I don't even, like, I feel like we have all the adequate depth we need at all the positions we need. They do work, like the way that you're saying it, like this roster throughout the year is going to feel very correctly configured.
Yeah, it's a coherent roster. It's it makes a lot of what we did pieces together in a way that I think we're going to like. We need those running backs to come through. We obviously need those upside bets to hit, at least some of them. But I just think it just makes a lot of sense.
Let's close on this. Let's each say our favorite pick from this draft. I will say my favorite pick was Quentin Johnston in the eighth round. I look at some of the players he's going around here, Sky Moore, Cooks. I definitely prefer him to those guys. I think he gives us immense upside, gives us the kind of profile we want to win in that 15 through 17 stretch, giving us our cheap but high upside exposure to the Chargers offense. Gretch, what was your favorite pick in this draft?
I want to go last. I got a few. I'll let these guys okay. go first.
All right, Karain. Favorite
pick. I'm worried I'm going to steal Gretch or
no. If you pass, you get to take whoever.
All right, I'm gonna say Travis Etienne, who okay. is a guy that I feel like I'm lower on than Sean and Ben, but
that was one of mine.
Yeah, I'm super excited to have on the team, partly because they've been talking him up, and it's one of those things where when I am trying to think through players, right, and drafting a ton of teams this year, drafting more teams than I ever have, and there's certain guys that sometimes get lost in the shuffle, or they're just hard to fit on my teams. They don't fit the way I like building teams as much. And that was kind of ETN for me for a lot of the off season. And then you hear the Tank Bigsby drumbeat, you know, they like him in short yardage. Don't like to hear that. They would like him as a pass catcher. That's not great. But ETN really pops in my stuff. Like he had a very strong rookie season as a rusher. He's a solid pass catcher. We think he's going to be on a very strong offense. He was a much, much stronger prospect than Bigsby. Like, that's not even – it wasn't even close. And it's like, dude, he's in the fourth round. Like, all of that risk is baked in. He gives you a ton of upside. You're getting a talent profile on an elite offense potentially. Maybe not elite, but they could be, right? They could break out. It's a breakout bet twice. Breakout on the offense, who has a very strong quarterback. Breakout on this really talented running back in his second full year. I'm trying to get back to being really, you know, comfortably overweight on ETN in my portfolio in best ball, and just psyched to get him on this roster where, you know, that upside swing in the fourth round is exactly what we wanted.
Sean, favorite pick?
Well, JSN is my favorite pick in every draft that I have been in this year. But outside of him, I'm going to go right back to the very beginning where I was saying, and we were all hoping that Kupp would fall in part because it would open up this potential to take those running backs in 3, 4, 5, 6. But with the way it actually fell, with Higgins getting to 3, with the decision to take JSN over Goddard and then getting those deep tight ends instead, I think that Christian McCaffrey, even if his ceiling now is a little bit lower, but we know that he did score well with the 49ers. And I mean, you're talking about a guy who is the only player. And again, maybe it's not this high now, but in recent memory to have sniffed 30 points per game, I mean, you're talking about the guy. And now to have McCaffrey, Etienne, and Dobbins together, and to potentially be able to play in a 2-2-2 format, three like top 6 overall running backs when you get into the tournament and still have all of the receivers that we have. So you have the flexibility if you're wrong, right? But to be able to play like 3 of the top 6 running backs in the tournament, I think it's going to be really difficult for other teams to match that who don't have those guys. So I actually love the way the draft fell in the first round for us.
Gretch, give us a walk-off favorite pick.
Well, I mean, we have a lot of fun guys. I think you could pretty much pick anyone from like round 1 to round 10, but I do think I gotta say T. Higgins. I mean, Higgins falling to 306 was the moment I was like, this is gonna be a really fun night. Like, that was this room's getting a little weird. We're getting some shit that's falling to us. This is gonna be awesome. I got T. Higgins actually ahead of Devonta Smith and a clear T. I think the whole industry has a clear tier break after both of those guys go. To get him 4 picks in a row that are non-receivers and get him to fall there, I think set up everything else really, really nicely. It's an awesome Waddle-Higgins combo when you already have everything Sean just said about McCaffrey. Just feels so good.
To be clear, do you have him as a clear tier break over Calvin Ridley, who went at the 209 in this draft?
I do.
Yeah. Okay. I thought that's what you're saying.
I have Ridley as, you know, 16. So there's 14 receivers if you don't count Ridley. I have Keenan Allen 15. I have Ridley 16. I'm not like going to be way out on him or anything, but I don't have him at 208.
You might be if this is the price.
Yeah, exactly.
All right. This was a treat. Always a blast.
Wait, what's your favorite pick?
I said mine. Quentin Johnson.
He said Quentin Johnson.
Oh, right. Sorry.
Yeah. I think those were all great choices there. Sean, any final words for this draft? Always a blast drafting with you here on the Ship Chasing channel.
Yeah, no, I just had wanted to say how much I enjoyed this, how much I like the team, and just express my gratitude to the three of you just overall, and how much I enjoy doing Stealing Bananas with Ben and reading Stealing Signals, you know, even and especially this last week where there's been so much cool stuff out. Obviously, Pete, doing the drafts with you this year, I mean, I get fired up for that every Wednesday morning. And then, you know, all of the amazing stuff that Pat has done in the last year, and then being able to read these legendary upside articles as they come out, and thinking through the tight ends this last week, and everything with that. It's a wonderful experience, and I love you guys, and I love this team. I think it's going to win the whole thing.
There you go.
Oh, yeah, man.
We love you guys too. Thank you for subscribing. Thank you for watching. Gretchen's going to cry. We will be back next Wednesday for a primetime draft on NFC. And then a week from tonight, we'll be drafting another main event team. Also, if you guys happen to be out in Vegas for the opening kickoff weekend, we will be out there. We'll be drafting FFPC teams, NFC teams, having a ship chasing party over at the NFC camp there at Park MGM. Would love to see you guys. Appreciate all you guys hanging out in the chat, bringing the heat, all of the hot takes. For Sean Siegel, for Ben Gratch, for Pat Corain, I'm Pete Overzet. This is Ship Chasing. We'll see you guys next week.